3 months and change out from the 2016 election. The Republican and Democratic national conventions have come and gone. And as I sit here, with all the different news feeds, intel, tips, connections that we have, the image is absolutely crystal clear. And we can see for miles and miles and miles what's coming. Hillary Clinton is 7 to 10 points behind nationally. If you translate it into battleground states, Donald Trump is going to be the winner of the 2016 presidential election. The mounting scandals, the mounting corruption, the mounting evidence that Hillary thinks she's above the law, the hacked emails where they were sending people to protest Donald Trump and blame Bernie Sanders, where they were lining up the superdelegates to block Sanders and bragging that it doesn't matter how they vote. We're putting a woman in and that's it. Talk about criminal activity. But they're betting that they are too big to fail. The system thinks that if they commit massive crimes that are interconnected to the entire bureaucracy, that the bureaucracy that's made up of the mainstream media, big corporate institutions, the major universities, the governing parasitic class themselves, and others, that they can put up a wall of fraud, a wall of disinformation, and make all of us feel like we're alone and powerless. I tell you, that facade has never had bigger holes in it than it does right now. And I can tell you that even if they cheat and install Hillary Clinton, it will accelerate the end of the New World Order. Now, by the way, reading back the last 60 years and studying the World Government Project that was launched by the Anglo-American establishment in the last 40 years, allied with the Communist Chinese, they have never had articles like the ones I'm seeing on a daily basis. A couple days ago, with globalization in danger, G20 doubled down on a defense. Here is The Economist today. Globalization and politics, the new political divide. And the Rothschild publication says, farewell left versus right. The contest that matters now is open against closed. When they mean open, they mean the globalists can do one-sided trade deals and let governments shut down their competition to consolidate control. So you have to translate that. And in this article, they say, quote, the future of the liberal world order depends on whether she, Hillary Clinton, succeeds. They're not exaggerating. They are wounded. They are on fire. They are collapsing. They are bleeding out. They are whistling past the graveyard. That doesn't mean there'll be some wonderful utopia on the other side of this, but this organized global corporate crime syndicate that's taken over much of the planet through fiat currency and fraudulent counterfeit financial instruments like credit default swaps and other derivatives, is in deep trouble. And they sell it like an open, wonderful world of rainbows and happiness when your borders open, like the jihadis in Europe and the collapsing standard of living. But then there's the evil world of the wall. So see, if you don't let us conquer you and run you and let TPP and offshore systems control you, then you're a racist. That's all they've got. They're going to play the third world off against what's left of the first world and bring us all down at the same time. Stay with us. We humbly come to you from deep in the heart of Texas, Austin, broadcasting worldwide. I'm Alex Jones, your host. This is the Friday edition, the 29th day of July 2016. We are 3 months and just about a week out from the 2016 presidential election. August September, October, November. Boom. This is a huge time to be alive. I have scores of articles out of The Economist magazine, out of The Washington Post, out of Time magazine, out of the Financial Times of London, out of Der Spiegel, out of the People's Daily in Communist China. Every day I see articles where the globalists, the G20, the major megacorporations that control the planet and that are destroying nation states and putting them into debt and transferring our wealth and establishing authoritarian systems of government they call technocracy, but are really just fascism on the top, command and control, using socialist or communist systems on the grassroots. A scientific tyranny. And they're all panicking. Economist magazine. Globalists must rally behind Hillary Clinton. The future of the liberal world order depends on whether she succeeds. They've rallied behind Merkel as well. She's arresting Germans. She's declared martial law. She is arresting anyone that criticizes Islam or the open borders. She has now announced a fivefold increase in migrants. She's going to hammer them to hell. But it's okay. She's a woman. They're now saying in the news, it's okay if Hillary stole the election from Bernie Sanders. It's okay if he really won California, New Hampshire, and at least eight other states. It doesn't matter if they order the delegates to lie and then go along with the superdelegates. And when they don't, they just replace them. Because she's a woman. Truly sick. But here's the good news. The Republicans tried to tell Republican voters that your vote never counted. Whoever said that? That's a conspiracy theory, you silly goose. And it was the media was like, Drudge is really getting crazy. He's pointing out that Ted Cruz kept having all these different voterless victories, and then he would announce that the voters had spoken. And there were talk of Federal Election Commission investigations. How dare Matt Drudge? Remember just three or four months ago, how dare he point out that no one voted in Colorado or all these other states? How dare Alex Jones, that evil person? There were articles as well, but 50-1 against Drudge. But I was mentioned as an arch criminal. And the kooky Republican voters, how dare them, George Will? In fact, can you guys print me the George Will article by the Washington Post front page? He said, we are the sovereigns. Dun, 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 dun. The royal Democrat and Republican Party. If Trump is nominated, the GOP must keep him out of the White House. And then you read the George Will article, and he just says, we're going to take it from you. We don't listen to a mere plurality of voters. That was in April, just a few months ago. So, here we are. The Democrats are completely angry. The vast majority we talked to across the country on video, including California, we're going to be making this case the next few months, compiling the graphs, the numbers, the polls, the videos, the interviews, to say to the American people, are you going to let them openly steal the Democratic nomination from tens of millions of voters and have all these incredible scandals and have their 20,000 emails come out that specifically show them saying, I don't care if he won this state, a woman's going to be the next president. You announce she won. We have the smoking guns. We have the giant red flags. We have the corpse. We have the evidence. We have the dead bodies. And so now we have 3 months. 3 months. And I'm going to brainstorm today on air. I mean, and my whole crew, my writers, my researchers, we're talking to demographers, statisticians. We are on it right now to just, I mean, the case is there. They admit it happened. Even the New York Post had to admit it. Even the New York Daily News had to admit that when Bernie was set to win New York, they just said, it doesn't matter. We have the superdelegates. Same thing in California. They met the night before at a rich donor's house with the Associated Press and CNN And the superdelegates had a discussion around drinks and decided what the results would be the next day. They even announced the number to themselves. The vote was totally ceremonial. Like your child pretending they're Captain Hook or Peter Pan in a fourth grade school play. You're not Peter Pan. You're not Captain Hook. It's a fantasy. So you've got the Economist, you've got the Washington Post, you've got them all these foreign powers, the Pope, the Communist Chinese, the Saudi Arabians, the current Mexican president, the former Mexican president, every socialist, every crook, every kingpin, every narco-connected leader, every piece of filth you can imagine, with more blood on their hands than you could ever imagine, with the Communist Chinese coming out from under their bloody vampiric catacombs, crawling out to tell us you can't have Donald Trump, and throwing everything they've got at Trump, and it's only making him rise because this is a symbol of a populist awakening worldwide, just like the Brexit and just like Catalan. They had almost 90% voted to leave Spain. It's the only now overall productive area of Spain. It's a third of their population. When I was there last year, almost every house and apartment had the Catalonian flag hanging out of it. Everywhere I went, people were listeners. I'd be in some little cafe and the woman would come out of the back and throw a whole nother big old piece of meat on my plate and say, it's free, we love your work. Help us leave Spain. I mean, this is happening all over the world. People are sick of it. They're tired of it. The productive are tired of being enslaved by far-off ruling leadership like the King of England, King George III in 1775. And so they push this whole plan of world government and openly say on The Economist, you're racist if you don't accept open borders, and if you don't accept globalism, and if you don't accept foreign shadowy groups running your countries. They always tried to deny they were setting up unelected corporate world government. But now that it's here, they're pushing it as a great thing, and everyone remembers and everyone knows. So as long as we force a debate on all these issues, there's nothing they can do. And I know I hammer that over and over and over again. But Catalonia voted overwhelmingly to leave. They voted. And then you look, the British press spins it like 47% wanted to leave. No, they actually voted to leave. And then Spain's trying to keep them from leaving. But long term, every analyst out there admits there's no way they're going to be able to keep that area in Spain, because it was never part of Spain. Spain was three different kingdoms to begin with, and then forcefully unified, what was it, 700 years ago. Portugal will be the fifth part, or the fourth part, depending on how you cut it. Now, continuing here, they say the future of the liberal world order. It's okay that it's world order because it's liberal. That means, you know, you have martial law, and you can't criticize Islam, and you have 90% tax rates in France. Some taxes are 101%. The future of the liberal world order depends on whether she succeeds. So that's the battle lines. With globalization in danger, G20 doubles down on defense. So we know what's going on. We know the stakes. So here's the question. What does Donald Trump do? Because he's the man who has the most power now globally to speak out against the new world order. Does he come out and say Hillary stole the nomination from Bernie Sanders, and then put on the evidence of it and show the states he really won, and bring former delegates up who were told, we're going to remove you and put somebody in who will pledge to Hillary. And we can play Hillary superdelegates bragging. It doesn't matter how many votes. In fact, we have that. Let's cue that up. Back in New Hampshire months ago, California superdelegates saying, it doesn't matter how you vote. Hillary will win. With total confidence. And then we have someone, I guess, later who was at that California meeting. We have all the evidence. Now we've got to put it on for everybody. Just because you're informed or I'm informed doesn't mean they're informed. And we have to remind everybody about the voterless wins. The voterless wins of Ted Cruz didn't succeed because we didn't drink the Kool-Aid. The Democrats didn't even really drink it, but they were able to ram it through and were willing to do it. So Trump's got to come out and say, if crooked Hillary would lie about emails and in her own emails talk about sabotaging my campaign and derailing Sanders, if she'd steal the nomination, will she try to steal the general election? You bet your bottom dollar. And I think he should make the whole campaign how she's a crook, which he's already done, but to the next level, and start predicting that now that I'm in the lead. See, if he was behind, he couldn't say this, because they'd use spin polls and say he was sour grapes. While Trump's ahead, he has absolutely got to come out and talk about the fact that they believe she will try to steal the general election because he's ahead. And everyone will connect with that because it's common sense and she's already done it. She's already robbed one bank, stealing the nomination. Why wouldn't she steal another? She's already engaged in all this corruption, all this crooked behavior. Absolutely. I'm telling you, we can destroy her right now if Trump drops the hammer and if you drop the hammer. Coming up, we dug up the clip from months ago with a Hillary superdelegate bragging that he was a California superdelegate, that he'd been one for decades, and it didn't matter how you voted, they were going to give it to Hillary Clinton because it's her turn. And then we're back there digging up. While I was just looking for that one, we found a bunch of other clips on national news superdelegates saying it 2-3 months ago. Just, you know what? Your vote doesn't count. We're taking it. Just like the Republicans did. Remember all those Republicans, superdelegates, going, we changed the rules in 1976, the Democrats in 72. We're just allowed to do whatever we want. We're going to do it. And we're just going to compile all that for the general public. Because when I show this to the average person, they go, yeah, everybody I know likes Bernie. Nobody liked Hillary. How'd she win? I heard they were kicking people out and stealing votes. Everybody's calling it election fraud because the general voter is so ignorant. It's beyond that. They stole it publicly. Do you understand? It's open and shut. They admit it. Fire torpedoes. Fire at will, people. Look, you watch. I'm going to be a machine. I'm getting all these videos together. I'm getting all the articles together, all the exit polls, and we're going to sit here and point out how she stole the election, the primary, and we're going to show how the Republicans tried to do it. We like a 10-minute mini documentary that lays this all out and then says, what do you think's coming up at the general election in T-minus 3 months and change? That's why I'm hyperventilating. The whole global government says their entire project is falling apart in Europe, falling apart in the UK, falling apart in the Middle East, falling apart in Africa, falling apart in Latin America, falling apart in the Caribbean, falling apart in the South Pacific. No one wants to go along with it. People are now knowing it's totally authoritarian. They're getting incredibly awake. Because let me tell you, the voters might not understand how the scam went down. They just know there was a scam. That's awake compared to a few years ago. And we're not going to sit here and watch the Associated Press that tabulates nationally the state's numbers coming in, and then they announce to us who wins. This is how they steal elections. And if you got somebody in the other party who isn't contesting it, like these other rigged elections, they can get away with it. But here's the difference. I want to get the article that goes with it and go over his name and everything else, guys. So let me have the article that goes with it. I want to repost it first and make a big deal out of it, because if I don't off all this, just no one even cares. Oh, here's a superdelegate months ago saying they were going to steal it from Hillary. A superdelegate saying we're going to meet in California and it doesn't matter. We need horns blowing and drum beats and smoke shooting up. I mean, folks have just gotten so calm with all of this. Well, I'm not calm. I'm not taking it like it's normal. And we need Donald Trump to come out and put the case on and say, crooked Hillary, you've stolen everything. You're a cheat your whole life. You stole it from your own voters. You're a total disgrace. And we are not going to sit here and let you steal these states. And Trump needs teams showing the illegals voting in California and everywhere else just to illustrate it that day. He's got some conventional thinkers who are good people, but they're thinking about just general demographics and trying to get more people to vote. You need to then, as a propaganda victory, show on election day illegals voting. If I had five teams in California, I could show you illegals voting hundreds of times in one day. I would go in, hidden cameras, show it all, devastate, devastate, devastate. I'm ready to devastate. I am not going to sit here and put up with this globalism anymore. And by the way, if anything happens to me, everything you heard here is how to defeat Hillary. This is the 100% super harpoon that'll bring Moby Dick down. And quite frankly, I don't care if I get taken to the bottom of the ocean. I got the harpoon in my hand, and I'm pledged to it, and pledge with me. All of you gather around, hunting the globalists. They're not going to defeat us. We're never stopping. You can see the electricity and feel it all around us. Hillary superdelegate, why your vote doesn't count. There it is, February 12th. Hillary already has over half the superdelegates and is expected to gain more. And that article by Kit Daniels breaks it down. We need to republish it. How Hillary bragged that she would block the popular vote and steal the nomination. And then we have them. 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 They stole the nomination. They are criminals. They're paid off by communist Chinese. They're enemies of America. We must defeat them, but we have to have the will to get in the longboats and get out there and get up on top of these people politically and start throwing. The march. What I'm going to do is open the phones up for the entire broadcast now, specifically brainstorming with you about, do you think I'm wrong that Hillary will try to steal the election? I mean, they're openly giving illegals driver's license in 15 states to vote. That's on record. And in California, Illinois, and a bunch of other states, they're trying to pass laws to legalize illegals voting, but then denying they're trying to do that. While they do everything they can to throw conservative voters off the voter rolls. So, yes, we know she's going to try to steal it, but how do we illustrate that? And how do we get Donald Trump, who I know is fully aware of it, and who I know is very concerned about election fraud, and I know who's put a team together to do it, how do we get him to come out and start illustrating Democratic Party election fraud that we know has happened in the past? And how do we get him to illustrate the fact that she just did it to her own party, and so that he's in the lead now in every major poll? Hillary, don't you dare try to steal it on election day. I think that's the smart move. I think Trump needs to preemptively put the case together in the next few weeks and needs to make that one of his central issues, because you can't not expect this White House, allied with crooked Hillary and this crime syndicate, to leave office. They are going to try to continue on with the fifth Clinton administration. And for all intents and purposes, that's what this will be. You've got two of William Jefferson Clinton, where she was co-president, pretty much ran things. You've now had two administrations of Obama that they heavily infested. And now you'll have her back as the royal witch, squatting right dead set in the middle of a fight between populism and globalism worldwide, with the Economist magazine and the Communist People's Daily and the Washington Post and the Financial Times of London and everybody else saying, we have got to get her in for the new world order. Says it right here. If the new world order is going to survive, we need Hillary. All hands on deck. Use a Star Trek analogy. They've got the alert noise, the alert siren going on in the background. And they are running around like an anthill that's been turned over. And believe me, 110%, they are going to try to steal this election. That is unequivocal fact. Unequivocal fact. So if Trump's advisors, some of them, are telling him, well, that'll look like you're a sore loser, or that'll look like, you know, you're a conspiracy theorist. Look, if you tell somebody you don't like the taste of their lemonade, they'll tell you you're a conspiracy theorist. That just means you're not supposed to have your own opinions or your own views. She just stole the party's nomination. I know most of the people in the Trump campaign understand this, and they're sitting around, I can tell you, trying to figure out how they deal with this because they don't have the machinery or the muscle or any of the apparatus to deal with something like this. They do have the lawyers. They can block states. They can do recounts. But just heaven help us, ladies and gentlemen. And listen, everybody's got to vote. We've got to have maximum votes. Even if your state is already going to go for Trump, you've got to go vote. So in the popular vote, he's way ahead of Hillary, you know, a million or more votes, so that we have the argument just morally above everything to trump their claims of something in the Electoral College. And I'm not saying ignore the Electoral College. You're going to have fraud in the Electoral College, just like you did with the delegates. And so the sabotage is on. The Republican establishment has decided to stand by and watch Trump be torpedoed to the bottom of the ocean at our greatest moment of victory. So here's the toll-free number to join us. 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Long-time callers, first-time callers, agree, disagree. A, do you think I'm right they're going to steal it? I mean, they're already stealing the election process. They're in the middle of a steal. There's no debate, but if you disagree, fine. 800-259-9231. But then obviously for the people out there that understand this clear and present ongoing process of theft that's going on, how do we expose it? How do we educate people about it? How does Trump go about responding to it? Because I am specifically going to ask you to lobby Trump and the Trump Organization. Obviously, folks listen to me, and I'm going to just stop right there. And I have put my 2 cents in. And I have said, you need to develop a plan now to start countering this now. And I know for 2 days after that, they were meeting on this subject and were already planning to be. They get it. They didn't get that from me. They just absolutely click and know that's what's going on. And this has to be dealt with. And I want to tell something to all the folks out there like Stephen Colbert and Mr. Stewart and all the other people like Mr. Fallon and everybody that think this is all cute and that think TPP is funny and think that, you know, foreign megabanks running our country is really, you know, something to make jokes about. And it's fun to make fun of InfoWars. We got clips of that coming up. And to sit there and, you know, talk about how I don't want any info. I'm waging war on information. I'm waging war on the truth because I don't want any data. No, information war can be neutral. It can be black or it can be white. We put out white propaganda. Propaganda doesn't mean a lie. It just means a statement, a political or religious system, an idea, something promoting your system, what you believe in. If you're a Christian, your propaganda is promoting the Bible and Christ. But it has a dirty connotation. There is white propaganda, neutral propaganda, and black propaganda. And they are putting out absolutely the most deceptive, weaponized disinformation against us. And it is Pentagon and CIA directed. That was legalized 3 years ago. Now, understand, the average Pentagon person, even in PSYOPs, is beside themselves. And that's why a lot of stuff's leaking. So there's blowback from it. But nevertheless, you were seeing scientific systems of control being used. And it's not funny to overthrow elections. It's not funny to make jokes about it. It's not funny to go along with it. So everybody better have a serious gut check and look in the mirror and say, do you want to really preside over the installation of Hillary Rodham Clinton? And I want to tell Bernie Sanders voters something, too. Do not go vote for a Green Party or for the Gary Johnson spoiler libertarian. I've always been for building third parties when you have a McCain-Obama ticket or something like that. We have a clear choice here. Trump is a nationalist. He was against the Iraq war. He does want to actually turn our industry back on. He wants prosperity. That's why the New World Order hates him, and he's part of a populist movement worldwide. Absolutely imperative that anyone that cares about the continuity of voting that hundreds of generations have fought for in history that you must, as a referendum on the First Amendment and the right of the vote and the right of the people to be heard, you must vote for Donald Trump. There is no question, no debate. If you don't do that, and if you don't get people to vote for Donald Trump, you are absolutely asking for everything you get. And this country is going to go under judgment. And if you don't believe in God, that's your issue. Historically, this will green light the establishment to go 10 times more crazy. They can't even help themselves. They're going to start big wars. They're going to grab more bank accounts. They're already doing more bail-ins in Europe. They're already, it's bad. Please, 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 if you're a bureaucrat or a minion of the system and you've played along with this for years because you feel like you're part of the winning team and you're scared right now and you think if you cozy up to this, you're going to be okay, you're not going to be. We're going into the final phases of this takeover, the end game. And they're setting up an authoritarian system because almost everyone's going to be made very, very poor. So if you were a sociopath, you should join Team Liberty because it creates more prosperity and a better future at this point. Yeah, 30, 40 years ago, 10 years ago, you could be a sociopath, work with evil, become powerful, get money. Not now, man. The slots are going to get smaller. The payoffs are going to get smaller. When elites consolidate control, they kill the golden goose. So I'm telling you right now, you need to do whatever it is you think you need to do to get information out, to leak information, to say no, to not play along with this. I mean, history's happening right now. Don't let this opportunity to reprieve yourself go by. Don't let this opportunity to do the right thing go by. This is maximum history flux point we've reached. We are in such an electric, incredible time. I just can hardly even contain myself. I am just on fire with chills right now at how mega epic this is. And don't think the globalists aren't going to strike back when, with Brexit and with the Trump presidency, but at least humanity's fighting back. We roll over to these guys, they want to break us for good. All right, I'm going to stop right there. I've got these clips I want to get to, a bunch of other news, your phone calls. We are running the biggest special we've ever run that we started running Wednesday. Most of the specials will continue through the weekend. A lot of things are about to sell out. We are going to have to stop the 40% off on super high quality storable food tomorrow. But everything else, well, a lot of the other items is going to run right through until Sunday evening. The purchases, whether it's the supplements or whether it's a Hillary for prison shirt or whether it is a film or a book on any subject of geopolitical import you can imagine, from the occult to 9/11, your purchase of these high-quality products is what makes this operation possible. We have the amazing nootropic. One of the ingredients is at least one of them, the second one's quasi-prescription. It's controlled in Europe. One of them's prescription, a serious nootropic for $17.76. Normally $29.95. Similar formulas are $60 to $70. And people get them from doctors, even though they're not prescription in the U.S. This has ingredients that are the highest quality nootropic, has building blocks that your brain needs. $17.76, and we will sell out of that by next week, so I have to end that special. 40% off BrainForce, 40% off Silver Bullet, colloidal silver. This was sold out until a day ago because it came back in. I'm still doing it. 30% off our flagship product, DNA Force, with the BioPQQ and more. 20% off all ProPure water filters. 20% off all Alexa Pure air filters. We already have the lowest price on all this. 30% off all Survival Shield X2. 30% off all Super Male Vitality. 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion. 30% off Secret 12, Vitamin B12. 20% off DNA Force. 20% off all Survival Seeds. The biggest selection out there, lowest prices. 20% off all T-shirts and other apparel. 30% off all Liver Shield. 30% off Deep Cleanse, Parasite Cleanse. 30% off Anthroplex, similar to Super Male Vitality, but a little less expensive. This is the dry formula. 30% off Knockout, the amazing sleep aid. And I want to salute and thank everyone who has been taking advantage of this sale, who have been wearing the Hillary for Prison shirts. You're making the news around the country. You're showing the power of grassroots activism. You're lighting the way to the future, even if they flip on the internet kill switch of how we're going to resist at the grassroots level with information warfare. And we're breaking through globally. I used to get attacked every few weeks on national TV. I'm attacked every day. CNN, MSNBC, all the big nightly shows, the comedy programs, Comedy Central, The Late Show. We got a clip of that coming up. We're having a giant effect. We're changing the narrative from the fantasy land, race war, globalist disinfo to how the New World Order is manipulating countries and populations against each other and creating dependency and creating poverty as a tool of control they call Agenda 21 and the Cloward and Piven stratagem. They admit their world government's in trouble in the People's Daily in Communist China, in The Economist magazine today, in The Washington Post, in the Financial Times of London. They say, mayday, red alert, our whole program is disintegrating. I've been on air 21 years. I've been politically active for 25 years. I've been reading globalist white papers and books since I was 12 years old, 30 years. And I've never seen these arrogant people say they're in red level crisis. I've never seen them running around mayday. If they were an old galleon ship, their hull be on fire, their magazines about to explode, there's 500-foot flames shooting up as their master engulfed in flame. Just keep firing into them. Blast them to hell. Send them to the bottom. So sick people cowering to the government, cowering to the criminal elements. It's not the government. It's criminals that hijacked it. They're so desperate, they're trying to start a race war and have the president and others actually promoting blowing police heads off and shooting people in the back. They're red-level criminals, and we're coming for them. What, you just think we could beat tyranny in the past? We can't do it now? All you got to do is have the spirit of indomitable strength that God's given us, that our forebears had, like George Washington had, and like Donald Trump's got when he's out there in front of those crowds, somebody rushes the stage to attack him, he rushes at them. All that is how a man acts. And the return of men is coming right when they try to launch their computer takeovers, right when they try to bring in all their robots and tell us we're ugly and worthless and increase the poison in the food and water because they're desperate. They're running around like chickens with their heads cut off. They're going down. They just went down with the Brexit. They're going down all over the world. All these fake countries and fake unions the colonialists built are falling apart. World government is neocolonialism. It's the final step. Mega corporations above the law with diplomatic immunity, wrecking our economies, exempting themselves from their economic warfare, and telling us how liberal they are all day and playing us off against each other in a great game balkanization program. Well, guess what? That's over. This is the beginning of the long march against tyranny. So listen to me. I want to thank you for your support. I want to salute you. And I want you to know, when you fund us, you see the action. You see more reporters, more stories, more devastating payloads in the InfoWar fired at the enemy with spectacular results. If InfoWars was a submarine, we've sunk thousands of globalist cargo ships, battleships, weapons carriers, missile cruisers. And now we want more submarines, more weapons to go out and devastate the enemy. No one's ever stood up to them. All we're doing is standing up. You stood up with us. Your funding is essential. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we cannot lose, even if Trump loses, because he was involved in the fight against tyranny. Donald Trump has already won. Donald Trump has already defeated the corrupt Republican Party system and changed it forever and led the way as a true trailblazer. That's the secret about the man in the arena. He wins whether he loses or not. The only way you fail is by not engaging. Now, we have The Late Show, CBS, with Stephen Colbert. And I guess his name is Eric Anders, who wanted to come up on stage, so I had him on stage. He said some pretty silly stuff at one of the speeches I gave at the RNC. But I'd make a big deal about it when he came and disrupted us. I didn't call the police on him like the Young Turks did. But you notice Colbert here tries to act like I'm waging war on information. He thinks his audience is stupid and doesn't know what InfoWars is. Information warfare, or IW, is a concept involving the use and management of information and communication technology in pursuit of competitive advantage over an opponent. Information warfare may involve collection of tactical information, assurances that one's own information is valid, spreading of propaganda or disinformation to demoralize or manipulate. That's black propaganda. We don't use that. The enemy and the public, undermining the quality of opposing force information and denial of information collected opportunities to the opposing forces. Information warfare is closely linked to psychological warfare. The United States military focus tends to favor technology and hence tends to extend into the realms of electronic warfare, cyber warfare, information assurance, computer network operations, attack and defense. But in our term, it is mostly used in information operations and more human-related aspects of information use. Social network analytics, decision analysis, and human aspects of command and control. We expose how things really work. We get into the nuts and bolts. We read from bills. We go through the gatekeepers and go right to the data. Now, that's what information warfare is in a quick snapshot. Vic Vreeland, who came with the name InfoWars, had been in, was it Air Force Intelligence, and he said, what you do is information warfare, and I knew what InfoWar was. He goes, here, let's go see what's available. And I registered that little baby in 1996, sitting at his house. He was the deputy fire chief at that time. And that's why it's called InfoWars, and no one else thought to go get it. Well, that's what we do, and it was, I think, meant to happen that that took place. But here they are making jokes on their audience, a form of information war, against them, hoping they think that I'm at war with enlightenment when it's the opposite. Here it is.
Yeah, I went to the RNC.
I did too. It was fun, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was exciting. Yeah. I jammed out with Alex Jones.
From InfoWars.
From InfoWars.
Yeah.
He's on a war against info.
Mm-hmm.
So
he's so against a war. He's so on a war against info. He doesn't want to even know about the Mation. No, don't care about the Mation.
He doesn't want any Mation. Just the info.
There's more. We'll be right back. Stay with us, second hour. Bill Federer has been on before many years ago. The American Minute ran into him at the RNC. He's going to be joining us in the third hour. Rob Dew will host the fourth hour on this Friday edition. But I'm brainstorming here, and I'm brainstorming with some of the Trump people. Not Roger Stone. I know someone even closer to Trump than Roger Stone. Making the joke, you can't get any closer. But I've been brainstorming with Roger Stone as well. That it's known that Hillary is ongoing stealing the nomination process, has now done that, and will try to steal the election. She's 7 to 10 points behind every major poll. She is in deep caca. So what do you expect him to do? What do you expect him to do? Well, we know what they're ongoing doing. They are stealing the election. It is happening. We're going to block it. We're not going to put up with it. And when you fight an election theft, you can beat it. And I think you should start fighting it before the final phase, because if Trump comes out and points out she already stole it from Sanders and shows the evidence that we're collating and others have already collated and has been collated, but we're putting together, then it's the end of Crooked Hillary. Everybody knows about her emails, all the lies. The time has come. The time is now. And we shall go on to the end, whatever the cost may be. We shall defend our republic. We shall never surrender. Let's go ahead and go to Greg in Wisconsin. Greg, what do you think? I mean, am I right? She stole it. They admit that. I mean, she's going to try to steal the general election, isn't she?
Yeah, I definitely think so. I was, I'm a truck driver, and I was at a restaurant 20 miles outside of St. Paul, and I was looking at the Pioneer Press there, and they had pictures of Hillary with big smiles and color that were huge. It took up like 50% of the paper. And they were talking about this sob story, you know, pushing these people, like this one woman who lost her husband, which is tragic, but she was basically using her. And the Trump pictures were him facing away from the camera. You know, people were dropping their glasses, dropping their signs. They were talking about how he was committing treason for daring Russia to get those other emails.
Well, I played the Trump clip a few days ago where he said, Russia, if you're listening, please release the other emails. The FBI admits at least four foreign governments were inside her server. That's their job. That's our job, is to get into their stuff. And so he's saying, please release it, which is what he should do. He doubled down. Instead of them saying, oh, look, you're a Russian agent, he's like, nothing to do with Russia. The point is that she's a crooked Hillary, so thank God that, you know, they're doing this. So we're going to play that clip coming up, since you mentioned it, because I was just thinking about how amazing that was this morning. What else do you think, Greg? What do we do to counter this?
Well, I definitely think that everyone needs to go out and vote, and I think that she's definitely trying to steal it. I mean, you know, I was watching the DNC, too, and I noticed that before Hillary spoke, 2 days before, everyone was up in arms and everyone was shouting at the stage, and then all of a sudden she gets on stage, and there was a line she said. She said, if I'm playing the woman card, then deal me in. And before she said, deal me in, there was a whole bunch of people who said, deal me in, and she was like a second behind. So there were plants in the audience.
Sir, it's admitted that all the real delegates, whenever they would leave to go to the bathroom, were not let back in, and then they put all their own people in. It's totally, completely synthetic, like a Hollywood movie. Like a third world nation, and this is the cult we're dealing with. Here's the good news, though. They have forever absolutely alienated much of their base that actually means well, that's against TPP and stuff. They're going to be joining the Patriot movement if we reach out to them. We can now deprogram all these socialists and liberals. I'm telling you, they're finally ready to understand what we're talking about. They weren't out protesting, really, Trump. They were out protesting crooked Hillary. Because they know, and a lot of them are going to vote for Trump now, which tells you he should win in a landslide or it's a fraud. Great points, Craig. I'm going to come back and talk to Stephen, Carl, Ethan, Justin, and others. 800-259-9231. First, I'm going to play three clips, though. Late Show with Colbert putting out disinfo against InfoWars. We're going to get to the superdelegate admitting they're going to steal it for Hillary. And we've got Hillary saying something very interesting. Information warfare in defense of the Republic. Waging war on corruption, crashing through the lines, and disinformation. The Late Show with Stephen Colbert, though, has come out with a new definition of InfoWars and attacked us. We're going to be playing that clip in full coming up. Your phone calls here in just a few minutes. But first, I want to play a clip from her speech last night. The DNC's now over. We're 3 months and a week and a half out or less from the general election. And she said, democracy is broken in America. Our voting system is in trouble. She's the one that just stole at least 10 primary states, 80-20 on the street nationwide, Bernie supporters. Hillary had crowds of 1,000, 2,000. He'd have crowds of 20, 30,000. She stole this. She lost the first primaries openly. They'd say it doesn't matter in New Hampshire. We talked to a California superdelegate. He said, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what Sanders does. She will be the nominee. And the Republicans came out and said the same thing, but we didn't buy into it, so they didn't get away with it. They've really miscalculated by openly stealing the election at the primary level and admitting it. Trump can now come right out and say, you are ongoing stealing the election. You are a fraudulent nominee. You have had your emails hacked that you sent protesters to disrupt our First Amendment and to blame Bernie. You should resign. And then the globalists might blow up Trump's airplane, but then everyone will know they did it. I mean, as long as we engage them, they lose. Even if they destroy Trump or destroy myself or go after Matt Drudge. I mean, I'm telling you, you already saw the Supreme Court justice drop dead. And then it came on the Washington Post. Oh, they covered it up because it was a secret society. Oh, that he got invited to. Oh, we were there and said, this place is like Bohemian Grove. And then a month later, they said it was a spinoff of Bohemian Grove. That's how tuned in we are. And I'm not bragging. But let me tell you, it's like a police detective that's been tracking a serial killer in an area for 20 years. After 20 years tracking a serial killer and you found 40-something dead bodies, you know this guy. You know him. And so many times when they actually catch him, it's exactly who the profilers thought. I have been doing this 20 plus years. I know these people. I know them. Let me tell you, it isn't hard to know they're going to steal this election. And Trump better fight it. And he is planning to. And I have an incredible responsibility, and so does InfoWars, to get all these people that have admitted they're doing this, to get the delegates together, to show how they did it state by state, to put the evidence on. It's been in the New York Daily News. It's been everywhere. Admitted that they met in secret in California the day before, and he was going to win by a landslide in early voting. They already knew, and they just said, these will be the numbers. This is how the superdelegates vote. And the superdelegates even voted to, like, have a percentage for Bernie, the made-up percentage they wanted. I mean, it's like tea parties with three-year-old girls or something. They just had a fantasy land deal. And it was okay because AP was there and CNN was there. Oh, the media was there. Don't worry, when we stole the primary that put Hillary over the top. So we're taking calls about how do we fight this? What do we do? What does Trump do? But more and more, we're going to write articles in the next few weeks, videos, you name it. We're going to hit Trump with them so he can retweet them, get them out. And the media will attack him if he just puts out the research, and then he can respond. That might be the best way. And I know the White House is watching right now. God, look at you unhappy people. You look like you're living in hell or something. You're unhappy because you're dirtbags out to get humanity. I know you're blackmailed and scared, Obama. I don't think you're as evil as Hillary, but you're pretty darn evil. And I know you think this is all funny, but deep down you know it's not funny. The globalists are in all these publications admitting world government's in trouble. You're never going to get that world government slot. You're never. Look at your UN event down there with the Olympics. It's a giant cesspool. Everything you do turns to absolute garbage. Let's go ahead and go to Hillary with the doublespeak, the 180 from reality about our democracy, our voting is in trouble, and she's the one that's going to save us from her. Here it is.
I believe our economy isn't working the way it should because our democracy isn't working the way it should.
And she's bought by special interest. Let's play that again. She's also bought by special interest.
I believe our economy isn't working the way it should because our democracy isn't working the way it should.
You're right. Here's the article from February 12th this year. Great article by Kit Daniels. It should be more hardcore. We're going to put it back out. I mean, I'm not blaming Kit. It's just hard to believe when this was first starting. And we were telling people in February they're stealing superdelegates. They would have national stories saying I was crazy, even though it was happening. So Kit said, Hillary superdelegate, why your vote doesn't count. Hillary already has over half the superdelegates and is expected to gain more. And this guy is a Democratic California, out of California, but a national superdelegate. And we've got him in the bar, you know, where they were having press conferences, admitting the entire thing. Mr. Valhalla, that's a cool name. Isn't that just cute? Isn't that just special? Bob Mulholland. And he is a superdelegate. You know, look, he was a Hillary superdelegate for California. So was the governor. This is a high-level Democratic operative, just arrogantly, just like the Republicans went on TV and said, your vote doesn't count. But he does a little bit smoother. He goes, Bernie, you'll get some. And you'll get a little piece of stuff off the table. Let's play the clip.
It sounds like Hillary is going to have a huge edge when it comes to superdelegates. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. And former DNC chairs like Howard Dean, who's from Vermont, he's known Bernie for decades, he's for Hillary. Yeah, the people who have worked with Hillary for decades are big supporters of her. If they haven't said so yet, they will over the next several weeks.
So roughly, when it comes to the Democratic National Convention, what is the rough total of delegates that are going to be available for the DNC?
Right now, about 4,800. So you need about almost 2,400 to get the nomination. And the way we work is that anybody who gets 15% more in election gets delegates. So this election will go all the way to California. Sanders will end up with well over 1,000 delegates, and Hillary will get the nomination.
Okay. Now, the superdelegates are basically what Hillary pretty much already has in her pocket. How many delegates does that amount to?
750 delegates. My guess is she probably has half of them committed to her. But she's out there working the precincts and working the states every day for every vote. And March 1st is Super Tuesday. At the end of the day, you will see that Hillary has the most delegates of regular people from caucuses like Iowa, from New Hampshire primaries, Nevada, South Carolina, and then all those states on March 1st.
Now, he did it slicker than the Republicans. The Republicans just went on TV and said, look, your vote doesn't count, never has. If I can have that George Will article, guys. You know, we are the sovereigns, we decide. But that backfired. But here he is. Oh, yeah, she's already got him committed. So it doesn't matter if Sanders really wins, just like New Hampshire. Right after this happened, New Hampshire, he got 20% more than Hillary, and she got way more delegates. That's how this works. And I know you, the audience, knows this. We've got to get this out to everybody. All right, I'm going to go to this last clip dealing with information warfare. Then I'm going to go to break and come right back with Stephen and Justin and Carl and Ethan and everybody else that's holding. I'm going right to you after this break for the balance of the hour. But here is Stephen Colbert on CBS with a comedian. I think his name's Eric Andre, one of the guys that climbed on the stage. I mean, I invited him up, wanted to hear what he had to say. And here he is making a joke about InfoWars, when information warfare means fighting with information, whether it's true or not true. We fight with the truth. But the point is, there's an info war going on. There's a war on for your mind. It's all about information. It's all about more information. It's all about how stuff actually works. They hope you just don't pay attention and they can lie to you about what information warfare is. Here it is.
See. I went to the RNC.
I did too. It was fun, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was exciting. Yeah. I jammed out with Alex Jones.
From InfoWars.
From InfoWars.
Yeah.
He's on a war against info.
He's so against the war. He's so on a war against info. He doesn't want to know about the Mation. Don't care about the Mation.
He doesn't want any Mation. Just the info.
So they're targeting low information voters.
I'm not entirely sure the crowd enjoyed your appearance as much as I did.
They didn't.
But I enjoyed it very much.
And they're telling him I'm low information.
Right here,
the opposite.
That's very exciting.
Alex! I just want an interview with Alex.
Hey, let's bring the Daily Show guy up here. I mean, you seem like you're upset.
I want you to have sex with my wife.
Hey, let's get this guy back on, and he won't use profanity, and he's really talking about.
You're not.
Coachella sucks this year.
And they went on from there. That's just crazy. They're saying that we don't want information, that we're in a war against information when we're here showing you how they're stealing the election, showing you by the numbers, going over the facts, showing you that the globalists are admitting they're bringing in a world government, that we're going under a TPP that is unelected and will control our lives to a great extent by multinationals that are tax exempt and above the law. And their answer is to make a joke out of it. Just like on other programs, Jimmy Fallon, they're up there going, you down with TPP? To Obama, he goes, yeah, you know me. So it's cute, TPP, targeting people in a happy state, drinking beer at home at 11 at night. Just laugh about TPP, foreign group taking over, and Congress not even allowed to tell the public what's in it, and all the rest of it. Because, you know, we're low information. Your calls are 4 minutes away. I'm Alex Jones. Hillary has stolen the nomination. That's on record. She's 7 to 10 points behind Donald Trump. Remember the Republican establishment said he could never get the nomination and that he could never pull ahead of Hillary? All lies. So if he's ahead, this is when he has to come out and say she's stealing. Not when they put out fake polls later saying he's behind and then he says she's stealing. Folks aren't going to fully understand that. Trump has to pre-strike. She's already stealing the nomination. He must target her with the truth and expose the rest of her crimes. America is ready. Ready to embrace the truth. All right, Stephen. Then Kyle, then Justin, Ethan, Carl, and others. Stephen in Florida, thanks for calling. You're on the air worldwide on this Friday edition, sir.
Yeah, hey, good afternoon, Alex. First of all, I've been meaning to bring this up every time I call and I forget. Your top-of-the-line water purification system, of which I've got one, is great. I was just wondering if it's coincidence or destiny that the first four letters in the name of it is A-L-E-X.
Well, that is the folks that have my Patriot Supply, now undoubtedly the biggest storable foods company in the nation, only after 8 years, because they have really good quality and very, very low prices. They consolidated like five big companies up in Utah who are already experts. And so we are the main distributor of it. It's a great gravity-fed filter. There's several other great brands as well, but depending on the specs, some are better than in one area, some are better than another. But I love the Alexa Pure. I think it's as good as it gets. Also, their survival type straw system they have is excellent as well. And we do sell all that. And again, we fund our operation with a gravity-fed filter that sits on your counter that you still get the good minerals, but not all the other bad garbage. It either totally removes it or removes it like 99%, depending on which compound. And this is what I use at my home and many other areas.
I just thought it interesting that it starts with the word Alex.
Yeah, I think they did probably do that. I mean they know for whatever reason that we're their biggest market, and so I guess it's Alexa Pure. I folks have pointed that out around here, but that name is not copywritten, so they're, you know, it's fine for them to use it.
So anyway, the reason I called about this whole situation with what's going on in the political scheme of things, and I remember some years ago you had given an analogy, and I fully agreed with this, and I still do, that America, you saw it like a passenger plane where it was in descent with the engines burned up. And then you said, now we're at the point, if you remember, where you said, we're now heading with the nose straight down and we're heading for a crash. Now, the thing I want to say is this, Alex, you look at what's going on, all the, progress, so-called, regress, the progress the globalists have made with the food, the water, the propaganda, the black propaganda through the media, dumbing down of our whole culture, the corruption in the political scheme, how we're trying to provoke our enemies into World War III, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it's, you know, Huxley's Brave New World, Orwell's 1984 on steroids. And here's what I want to say. I have a greater concern, as much as I hate the fact that we have a prospect of an evil person like Hillary becoming our next president. It's going to be far worse than Obama, that's for sure.
No, I hear you. And if we get, you know, Hillary in, she's going to try to totally collapse the country further, get us into wars, but it will wake people up faster. My whole point is that if she openly steals the election, she will go in as a wounded, floundering platypus.
Well, here's my main concern, though, with that analogy again about the passenger plane. This is what people don't understand. The main thing is not what the globalists are doing. What I see is an invisible hand that has its hand, and at the back, the tail of that plane.
Sure, the big mega banks are trying to scuttle the country so they can consolidate not just our nation but others. It's the same program, and Trump just doesn't want to destroy America. He's not perfect, but he doesn't want to destroy the country.
Yeah, no, that's not what I mean, Alex. Okay, here's the thing. You mentioned yesterday and today about the judgment of God. We have made God our enemy, and just like ancient Israel, when you read the Bible, he is now unleashing, he is allowing our enemies to take us over. And it is because we have made ourselves his enemy by what we are doing. And the main problem in America, I said this to Zakari the other day, or Zakari, is the fake Christianity in here that's supposed to be the conscience.
Listen, I totally agree with you. God bless you. I got to jump, go to break, come back with more calls, but you're dead on. Thank you so much, sir. It is the fake Christianity. I'm not on some Pharisee high horse and I'm Mr. Perfect, but they just don't fight tyranny. They don't fight abortion. They don't fight. Talk about literally being brought under God's judgment. Drug-resistant TB is killing record numbers of people. It's exploding all over the country, mainly in primary and secondary schools, where they just put illegals in with it to spread it instead of giving them treatment. I mean, talk about consciously bringing plagues upon America. We have people in office who literally want us to collapse. So they're bringing in poor, helpless, diseased people.
We're on the march,
and they're not even treating them. I'm going to get back to what George Will said after I take about 7-8 calls in April about how there's no way he'd ever pull ahead if he was the nominee of Hillary. And he's now 7-10 points in dozens of juicy polls. Oh, I'm afraid Donald Trump's going to be elected the next president. Number 45, what a perfect number. I'm afraid the Republic's going to actually fight for its life. I'm afraid Russia is as well. And the UK, oh, there's so many problems. And now all 25 plus members of the EU have started referendums to leave. Oh, things aren't going too well. They've hit the emergency button. The globalists are running around in their smoke-filled cabin. Their ship is on fire. It's a red alert, ladies and gentlemen. And we've got Donald Trump saying, is that a dog, when she does the dog barking? What about the hyenas? Now, I'm going to go to your calls right now. I just want to point out that we are running the biggest special. People might say, well, a couple months ago, you said it was the biggest special ever. Yeah, because we're just expanding these specials more and more. We're running the overall biggest special completely across the board. 40% off Brain Force, the nootropic, 40% off Silver Bullet. Usually it's like 20% off some things, then like maybe 50% off one thing or 30% off a few things. This is like 40%, 40%, 40%, 40%, 40%. 40% off storable foods, 40% off Silver Bullet, colloidal silver, 40% off Brain Force, 30% off Super Male Vitality, Super Female Vitality, Vitamin Mineral Fusion, 30% off. Great way to get all the vitamins and minerals and cofactors and amino acids into your kids. Great fruit punch. 30% off bioavailable vitamin B12 sublingual. 30% off DNA Force. That is big. 30% off DNA Force. 20% off all survival seeds. 20% off all shirts. 30% off Liver Shield. 30% off Deep Cleanse. 30% off Anthroplex. 30% off Knockout the Sleep Aid. And it goes on and on and on and on. But take advantage, because there's a few things that are going away tomorrow that we're either selling out of. It's more than a few things. I got to go meet after the show. I know of at least four or five things that are about to sell out. So on top of all these specials, you can get free shipping on orders of $50 or more, and additionally 10% off on any items you sign up for auto ship. Infowarsstore.com or toll free 888-253-3139. And I want to thank you all for your prayers, spreading the word, and buying the products. We're self-funded. We're like 30% sponsor-funded, 70% funded off PrisonPlanet.tv subscriptions and water filtration systems and nutraceuticals and things. And Hillary, for prison shirts. You know, usually shirts are just a statement to fight for the Second Amendment or to meet like-minded people. They're not a big chunk of our funding. Now they are. You know, before it was nutraceuticals. Right now, what's floating the boat is the T-shirts. So we're going to be moving into more and more of that. So thank you all for your support. God bless you, and I salute you. You are the InfoWar. Okay, who's been holding the longest here? We've got Justin in New York. Then I'm going to go to Kyle, Ethan, Carl, and Andy. We're going to go to everybody in this segment. Let's go to Justin in New York. You're on the air. Thank you for joining us.
Hey, Alex. Thank you. I've been listening to your show for about 4 years. I really appreciate what you do.
Appreciate you, man.
I've been doing some research on, you know, how election fraud may or may not have taken place in the history of our country. And I think really a big game changer, especially in the 21st century, is these voting machines. You know, I seen the video there that David Knight did while at the DNC about the Microsoft voting machines. Now, I know that there's several ways that Hillary Clinton can steal the election. I would like to. I know you had mentioned before.
Yeah, we're going to get Bev Harris and others on. I used to have the Collier brothers when they were still alive on, and others. There are thousands of admitted cases of election fraud. We've had Diebold chief engineers go public and explain how they were ordered to do it. We've had both parties do it, but historically, the Democrats are the kings of retail fraud, dead people voting, illegals voting, and the kings of electronic fraud over the Republicans. It's just a historic fact that they are the kingpins. It doesn't mean they don't do it. And there was some evidence that they were cheating Al Gore in Florida. Gosh, I don't know who's worse, Al Gore or George Bush. The point is, I'm for the integrity of the voting system. I just tell it like it is. And if we see any evidence of overzealous Trump people engage in election fraud, I will stand against that, because we can't turn into who they are. But we need to really be exposing what's happening, because this could be one of our last, I think probably the last so-called election if she steals it. I mean, we'll still have elections, but it'll be like the old Soviet Union.
Really just wanted to get out there, though, that I think, like, I'm taking a look at these polls where Trump is 7 to 10 points ahead, and that's fantastic. What I'm afraid is that they will take these voting machines and tweak their quote unquote algorithms to rig the elections to where even if Trump is 7% or 10% ahead in the nation, that they will rig it to compensate for that, to where no matter how much he's ahead, they're still going to steal it.
Historically, it's very hard to steal a landslide unless it's, you know, a Stalin election. And if they do that, we're having very serious talks personally, and I know I've had those with Stone. Like, let's try to get Stone on. It's a quickening. I'll try to get Stone on, maybe even to pop in the last 10, 15 minutes, or this Sunday. I'll be here live 4 to 6 p.m. because I want to have a whole hour-long discussion about what do we do if they steal the election. Because for me, and I think Stone agrees, and I think the Donald knows this. I know the Donald knows this, that this is a real issue and front and center.
Absolutely. You know, another thing is, and this might be an even easier option for Hillary, is to rig the polls so that when the election comes about, they can rig the election as they had planned and say, oh, well, you know, Hillary's been winning this entire time anyways. There's no way the election.
Sure, and they'll have George Will and an entire group of rhinos come out and say, we told you he'd always lose. See, we're right. See, we're right. See, we're right. Absolutely. Great point. Yeah, look, it's important he have a big margin in the popular vote because that's a moral authority. They are going to try to steal California. I think he's going to win in California. I know a lot of Hispanics who are citizens who love Trump. In fact, some polls show upwards of a half. In fact, remember he got the vast majority. There were still like 6-7 candidates in major states of Hispanic voters who were Republican. But I know a lot of people who aren't even citizens that like Trump. Again, it's a bullying lie that, say, Hispanic Americans don't want border control. They're not idiots. In fact, they know better than other people. In fact, even ABC News, remember, and even Scarborough, NBC, had his liberal reporters on going, look, I went down to the border, and it's Hispanics want more border control than the Anglos or blacks. Do you have any idea what it's like down there? I mean, it's really scary in many areas. And it's people from China and Guatemala and Syria. I mean, it's scary, folks. At one Border Patrol sector in South Texas, you can look the numbers up. Last time I looked, it was tens of thousands of other than Mexicans in 1 month. And I don't mean Nicaraguans, El Salvador. You know, I mean, that was a big part. It was all over the world and some scary hombres. I mean, it's like leaving your back door open at night. They try to take common sense and act like it's insane. You see, Trump owns a bunch of hotels. And you can't get local help from the college students and all those folks because it's seasonal. You got to have people that are trained, know what they're doing. And he brings them in from Latin America, Asia, Eastern Europe. And Trump, that's what Trump's going to do. They're going to go in there with computer systems. And if somebody isn't a felon and wants to work and gets into the system, you're going to be, boom, just, I mean, we're talking a week. Boom, you're here. You're a felon. You're a criminal. You're an aggravated. You are gone. You are rounded up. You are put on an airplane and your butt is thrown out of the country. Period. In fact, a lot of folks actually know Trump say, get ready for a lot of immigrants. They're going to be good ones, though. Let's go ahead. But again, they want a bunch of diseased people and a bunch of homeless women with kids to bankrupt everything and to be wards of the state. You know, people sit around and make fun. One of the underlying racisms I do hear is Even you know, gentrified Hispanics do it. Oh, look at the Mexicans cutting the yards and fixing the houses and doing all this stuff. That's what everybody 20, 30 years ago still knew how to do. But daddy was doing it. And we were an agrarian farmer civilization. So just like my grandfather knew how to roof the house and do carpentry and fix machines and work outside and all that, we go, oh, look at this Mexican work ethic. That's just a farmer work ethic. That's a rural work ethic. Those are rural people that were kicked off their land all over Mexico and don't have anything they can do but come up here. There's been a program to make them go up to the maquiladoras. So I don't blame them not wanting to be in those maquiladoras, those horrible factories, so they come over here. I don't blame them. The point is people look at, oh, my God, this work ethic. Oh, my God, it's true. That's what people were like 30, 40 years ago, 50 years ago in this country. But our rural communities have fallen apart. So everybody's in there drinking Jack Daniels and watching satellite TV all day and NASCAR. And there's a moral ethic in the country that's collapsed. I mean, it's still better than the city, but I'll tell you. Third, fourth, fifth generation Mexicans in East Texas that hang around with my family are rednecks with a shade darker. They are watching satellite TV drunk, and gambling and running around and acting exactly like the white people. It's frightening. You want to see what it looks like? Watch the movie shot right outside Austin. I'm going to your calls. Called Joe. My uncle, my dad's brother, literally owned the same blue Chevy truck for 30 years. It's just crazy. The way the houses look, the way the people are, absolute pure research. That is exactly what it's like. Redneck Mexicans, you name it. It's the whole nine yards. So I'm telling you, it's the culture in America, all the decadence that has turned us into these slobs. I don't care if you're black, Hispanic, white. If you don't keep the work ethic on your kids and all the rest of it, they will turn into ruined slobs. It's television. All right, I don't know. That's just some sociology for you folks. Andy. No, you've been home the longest. You've been home the longest. Ethan in Pennsylvania. No. Kyle, I'm sorry. Kyle in Texas, third time's the charm. Kyle in Texas, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex. Basically, I agree with you on this, that we need to hit this on many different fronts, and expose Hillary for who she is, because this is the time. I mean, you've got the Bernie supporters. They know that she's crooked. You've got even Black Lives Matter. They know that she's crooked. I mean, everybody's waking up to the fact that Hillary Clinton is a crook. And, you know, now is the time, I believe, to hit this and hit it on the information front. We need to be everywhere that Hillary goes in big groups and definitely expose her for who she is.
I agree. I mean, again, I don't have the words to describe how important historically this time is. I mean, how would you describe it, Kyle?
I believe that our democracy is being stolen from us as we just sit back and go about our daily lives, you know, just watching TV. And
what do we do to counter Hillary? What do we do to counter Hillary?
I think the main thing that we have to do to counter Hillary is to post on our Facebooks. I mean, you can't be scared to just put this information out there and to expose who she really is.
I agree. Folks should go to Infowars.com and get the flashback of the superdelegate from California saying in February, we're going to ignore the popular vote, and get all the clips of the Republicans saying it and just keep hammering it. We're going to have more articles, more videos exposing this. And I think we push Trump. Do you agree with me that Trump needs to come out and say, she's been stealing the whole time, she's going to continue, I'm ahead, she better not try to steal it?
Absolutely. Trump, I believe Trump should say something. You know, if he plants the seed out there and we all get together and put it on our Facebooks, we put it out there through the InfoWar, you know, because, I mean, there's too much evidence out there. You've got James Comey saying that she lied. You've got everything shows that they're trying to get the felons to be able to vote now. They're trying to get the illegals to be able to vote. I mean, it's just so blatant.
While they deny it, they go, oh, you're a racist. Someone shouldn't have to have an ID or a license or, you know, even a bill that it's their name. No, and then they're legally trying to get it done. I mean, imagine you went to Mexico or China, only let you really vote in China, and said, I want to vote. They'd laugh at you. God bless you. I appreciate your call. I'm going to skip this network break, so I have more time to take calls. I'm going to go to Andy and others here in just a moment. Carl's up first, though. Before we go to Carl, this is an information war. And I wouldn't get on the level of the minority of people that still support Hillary, because it's not really many of them. Like, oh, please listen to me. And then they get this arrogant look like, you're weak and my lady's going to win. I'd say, listen, I know Trump's not perfect, but, you know, they stole it from Bernie. And we need to support the integrity of our election system. Don't you know she's going to try to steal it from Trump? We need to landslide for Trump, so it's very hard for them to steal. That's what every expert tells us. History shows it. Landslides are hard to beat. We need a landslide. And it's looking that way with all these emails and corruption just proving she's so crooked. I mean, let me tell you. 6 months ago, nine out of 10 people in Austin I know are for Sanders. I mean, and I don't like that as a socialist, but at least he wanted to reform the big banks and make them pay some taxes and stuff. I agree with that. I just don't agree with socialism. I mean, they robbed it. I mean, I know they stole it. That's admitted. But I can't find anyone that supports him. I mean, I'll see. Again, yesterday I was driving. I played the game driving home. And doing some errands. I took the kids to a movie. After that, I played the game of trying to find a Hillary sticker, and I didn't see one. I didn't see one in a Democrat city, one of the only ones in Texas. I didn't see one. The other day, I drove around for 2.5 hours taking care of business and going getting my dental work done and stuff, and I ran into one Hillary sticker. But let me tell you, you go to the rich part of town, almost every yard's got one. Man, it's the rulers. The whole power structure hates Donald Trump. Both parties. George Will got up in the Washington Post and said, like, let me read that, then I'm going to your calls. If Trump is the nominee, the GOP must keep him out of the White House. Boy, and imagine if Hillary steals it, they'll support that. Just pure evil. Republican voters, particularly in Indiana and California, can, by supporting Cruz, make the Republican convention a deliberative body rather than one that merely ratifies decisions made elsewhere. Some of the 6 months earlier, a convention sovereign duty, the royalty of the Republican leadership, is to choose a plausible, they decide who's plausible nominee, who has a reasonable chance to win, not to passively affirm the will of a mere plurality of voters recorded episodically in a protracted process. In Texas, we call that Bravo Sierra. He goes on to say Trump would be the most unpopular nominee ever. He's already got higher points than Mitt Romney. Mitt Romney was behind this time last year, 3 points. Trump's 7 to 10 points ahead in every major big fat poll, buddy. So you're proven wrong, George Will. George Will is a anti-American piece of filth. Anti-voting. And I'm going to finish this in a minute and go to your calls, but notice the early caller said our democracy, and a lot of patriots, a lot of constitutionalists get mad by that term. But listen, we're a limited democracy. We have a constitutional republic. But yes, in a pure democracy, a 51% vote to say kill all the redheads in the country, it happens. Or a 51% vote to kill all people with, say, brown eyes, it happens. Or kill everybody that, you know, that has got freckles. Or kill everybody that's black. In a republic, you have a codified system so that basic systems are protected. Like voting. Like free speech. Like the Second Amendment. Like the right to not be searched without due process or probable cause. These are all of our shared values, and we have to defend them to the end. And I'm seeing them run over by the establishment at a level never imaginable before in America. He continues, this is George Will in the Washington Post. Trump would be the most unpopular nominee ever. Oh, no, he's actually one of the most popular since Ronald Reagan. Quote, unable to even come close to Mitt Romney's insufficient support among women, minorities, and young people. In losing disastrously, Trump would probably would create down-ballot carnage sufficient to even the Republican control of the House ticket. Splitting is becoming rare in polarized America. In 2012, only 5.7% of voters supported presidential candidate and congressional candidate of opposite parties. So they all sold this talking point. It was all fraud. It was all lies. Again, just very briefly, we're running the biggest special in our history right through this weekend. Some items will stop being on sale tomorrow. Storable foods, 40% off, highest quality, are the lowest prices. And 40% off, it is a joke. Loss leader. 40% off colloidal silver, silver bullet. 40% off the incredible nootropic brain force. 30% off a bunch of the other products of Super Male Vitality. Lung cleanse, you name it. 20% off apparel. 20% off Alexa Pure Breeze home air purifier that costs $200, $180 right now. And leading competitors are $400 to $800 to $1,000 and aren't even as good. A lot of folks just lazily sell the same filters. Filters have gotten less expensive. So there you go. It's all available at InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And your purchase of the products makes everything we do possible. Support our local affiliates as well. And I salute you and thank you. Let's talk to Carl in Oregon. You're on the air. Then Andy, Ethan, Brian, Todd. Carl, go ahead.
Hey, buddy. It's your buddy.
Welcome.
Alex Jones. Alex Jones, blow up the Death Star, a 52-week Patriot contest. It can be done. We can do this. We can take back America. The contest is structured where everyone that can hear this, and you can fund this, it's easy to do, 52 weeks. You put up, create flyers for the people that participate in it every week all across America. And the people that have the most flyers put out, it could be on any topic, anywhere between aspartame to Zionism, anything about the truth movement, they could do this. And each and every week, somebody puts out, you know, a certain amount, more than 10,000, wins $1,000 that week.
Carl,
if we do this,
Carl, I'm going to jump. I appreciate your call, but since you mentioned that, we did a contest. I think it was for $5,000 to expose the dangers of flu shots. You know, just put the fact that you should read the insert. Flu shots have killed people. And it was in hundreds of newspapers and hundreds of TV stations picked it up, tried to imply it was illegal to put up flyers in legal and lawful areas. They tried to threaten me that it was my fault. Of course, that all failed. But I agree. I'm going to launch a flyer and video contest next week. It'll be a month long. And we'll have phase two of that successful for like, I think, $10,000. Here's the problem. I don't have the crew to watch all the videos, see all the flyers, even report on it, but I'm going to try. In fact, we have a contest I announced yesterday that we need to tell folks where to send the meme of Hillary as a shark. Send it to us on Twitter. Tweet it at Real Alex Jones. In the next hour, we're going to post some of those on Infowars.com so you can spread them. That photo of her like cresting like a great white shark. Hillary devours Constitution, Bill of Rights, Infowars flash contest. I've only got like 7 or 8 writers that are actually, you know, here in-house. A lot of them are resting right now because they've been up for the last 2 days. So we've got to go through those contests. I'm going to announce a $1,000 winner on that. But it isn't about the money. It's the fun of exposing tyranny. So send those to showtips at Infowars.com as well. Post them on your own Facebook. Tweet them at Real Alex Jones. And will this save the world? No. But all of us together doing things like this will encourage the First Amendment that they hate and bring this globalist down. So we should come up with kind of our own flyers, our own promo video, explain what's got to be in it. And just expose election fraud, expose how Hillary stole the nomination, expose how she's planning to do it to Trump. You should be doing those videos anyways. You should be doing stunts anyways. You should be doing whatever it takes, especially in battleground states like Florida and New York and Pennsylvania and Ohio. And yes, I think we can win California, but regardless, maybe you're a businessman. Pay to have banners fly. You put your money in or we're going to lose everything. Do stuff like do big projections up on buildings, you know, that say Hillary wants to steal the election. Do stunts in front of media that's legal and lawful. Fight for the Republic, the animating contest of liberty. We're on the march. The empire's in deep trouble. We'll be back. Stay with us. 70 seconds. Tax you while you drive. Surveillance cars rolling out. They cost more and they're ripoffs. That's what 250 square foot coffin apartments are about. You pay more than you would for a 2,000 square foot apartment under their plan. It's all about raping you, but calling it trendy. And then all the good trendies get the little car, the little coffin apartment, and they're all proud of themselves. It's fun to be a chump. Andy in Maine, thank you for calling on this Friday worldwide transmission.
Hey, Alex. Listen, I had a couple of ideas I wanted to put out there. First of all, I know in my voting district here in Maine, all of the volunteers are elderly people. And I really think that it would be good if we put out there that if you have the time, volunteer at your voting station so that you can be on hand. Also, I think it would be a good idea maybe to organize exit polls at your district.
Yes.
So that you're there to actually do an exit poll yourself. To account for these votes, I'm posting a group on Facebook that's going to be called, and I'm posting it in the next half hour, called Vote Protectors. And I'd like to invite everybody to go there so that we can at least have a discussion.
Absolutely. I mean, I wish I had the money to have reporters in like all 7 or 8 battleground states at the key counties that are always contested to have Leanne McAdoo, Joe Biggs, David Knight. I mean, I'm going to send reporters 50 feet away from the polling place, you know, wherever it's legal and lawful, and then talk to folks, who'd you vote for? Now, that's what you're supposed to do to you know, check the integrity. I remember with Pat Buchanan, was it 1996, but I was working in there. I was even paid like, I think, $2 an hour as part of it. I mean, I didn't want the money, but that's part of it. And I remember Pat Buchanan had like 70% of the vote, but at the end of the night, they said he had like 5% or something. And everyone knew they'd stolen it from Pat Buchanan. We could see on the Scantron bubbled in Pat Buchanan for the Republican nominee, but they stole it. There were Pat Buchanan signs everywhere. Well, here's the deal. Trump's got the money and the system to fight it. What are you expecting to happen? What's your gut tell you?
Well, my gut tells me that Hillary will do anything that she can. I mean, she has so many operatives out there. And we have to, at a grassroots level, locally, in your own district, where you live, whoever is listening right now, take an action. You talked about getting a radio show of your own and all that, but you know what? This is something that is simple. It's easy. You just have to commit to it in your district. If
all you do is call the county clerk or the head of elections, and they tell you where to come sign up, and you'll get put in there. And listen, when they're stealing it, they'll say, no cameras. Everyone turn cameras off. And that's when you videotape, and you get that out. And I'm telling you, we get enough of these when they're stealing them, there'll be an investigation, a Supreme Court situation, which is why they killed Scalia, so it could go for Hillary. I'm telling you, they got it set up. But I'm telling you, we'll show them stealing it if we got enough people inside the central systems, not just at the precinct levels. We need to be precinct, but more importantly, the central hub of your county is where the dirty deed's going to go down.
Absolutely. I also wanted to mention how encouraged I am, because I have a 14-year-old. I know you have a son about the same age, and how encouraged I am by the number of awake kids in that age group, in the high school level. And
I'm sorry to keep interrupting. You're just making all these bombshell points. You're such a great caller. I'll hold you over so you can add more points if you want to. But listen, my son is 13, about to be 14, and my older daughter's 12. They say everybody at the school basically listens to me, and I talk to other folks around the country. They say InfoWars is super hot with young people.
Absolutely. I mean, I'll tell you, my son, he has a Instagram page called Northeast.conservatives at Instagram, and they shut him down. They censored and suspended his account for things just for simple Hillary commentary and memes.
But that's going to teach him to fight back even harder, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he's a huge fan of Milo, and when he heard he got banned from Twitter, he thought it was the greatest thing ever, because that goes to...
Let me ask you this question, then we'll go to our guest. I'm going to come back, but I want you to finish up talking about what has your son done to get other platforms, his own platform, so they can't censor him, because that's the answer. We're now into the third hour of this worldwide broadcast. The fourth hour is coming up that Rob Dew will be hosting. Again, if you're new to the show, I do 3 hours every day. Then one of our other great reporters, researchers, or guest host does the fourth hour. Many times I co-host with them. Then we have the nightly news, 7 o'clock Central, Infowars.com/show. And now many TV stations and cable systems are picking it up, even though I haven't gotten the phase of really promoting that yet. And what's also happened is a lot of radio affiliates are picking up the nightly news that's an hour long and carrying it. I never expected that. But we have innovated a lot of stuff in media. I didn't go out and get a cable channel like Glenn Beck did. That's one reason he's going bankrupt. In fact, I've been offered his channel. That's how I knew he was in financial trouble 3 years ago. I was offered it behind the scenes for much less than he got it. And I said, no, I don't want to be channel 2000 and something and say I have the Alex Jones channel, because the audiences are so small. Maybe 50,000, 100,000 an hour. I can shoot YouTube videos, you know, get 1 million views in an hour. I mean, it's just crazy. So, again, we are free to air, though, on a satellite system that costs us $300,000 a year that UHF, VHF, and cable systems say they like the best. We also are on a file sharing system that they can also get us on. And that's our next phase, is pushing that. I've been so focused on just fighting the globalists and fighting for open, free elections in this country that we are about 6 months behind on that project. But we're ahead on other projects. But that's very, very exciting. So I'll also be back doing the Sunday radio / TV show, 4 to 6 p.m. Central, live in studio, as we do every Sunday. We have a man who I ran into when I was out on the street in Cleveland at the RNC, who I've had on several times many years ago, who really has one of the most informative news vignettes I've ever seen, and that's the American Minute, AmericanMinute.com. We'll talk to Bill Fetterer here in about 3 minutes. Briefly, there's a lot of news I didn't cover today. I've dropped the ball because I've been so focused on the Financial Times of London, the BBC, the Economist, the Washington Post, saying world government's in trouble, the New World Order's in trouble. They actually say that, and that Hillary must be elected. Clearly, she stole the nomination. That's admitted. We have superdelegates on the website admitting it. They're very proud of it before it happened. And now they've done it. So she's going to try to steal it. And Trump knows that. So what do we do to fight back against this? I think that's a main focus. And I'm going to be hammering this. But separately, it's happening. We're getting conditioned. Even though we know about all this corruption, We just get used to them lying to us, used to Hillary stealing elections, and accustomed every two or three days to a cop getting executed. Several got shot in San Diego. One's dead. One's fighting for their lives. And there's the customary people online. We have stories on Infowars.com celebrating the dead cop. And this is the White House. Every time somebody gets killed, you know, they say, well, the cops need to reform. San Diego police shooting. One officer killed, one rushed to surgery in another ambush. And this is what's going on. And whether it's Islamic or whether it's another Black Lives Matter affiliated group, they always try to cover it up why they did it as long as possible. If your name's Ali, they change it to David. If you're a black national, they call it a right-wing attack. I mean, this is the 1984 level we've reached. And we're going to be talking to Bill here in a minute about all of this and about the history of this country and how if we rediscover it, we'll know why the globalists want to demonize it so much, because it's the antidote to their world system. There's two world systems in competition, centralized conquest and open free market. We never fully realized the open free market, but the little bit we did revolutionized the world. So we'll be talking to him in 2 minutes. But Andy in Maine, your son, you said, had a popular Instagram and that it got banned. This has happened to family of mine that even put up mild things critical of Hillary, because they really don't want young people having their free speech. They want to teach you that they're going to censor you like Facebook's been doing. The answer to that is getting a YouTube channel, starting a bunch of Facebook channels, fighting back. YouTube tried to censor us last week. I threatened to sue them. They backed off. I'm not looking for trouble, but we have to keep the internet open and free. Go ahead and finish your story.
Absolutely. Again, northeast.conservatives at Instagram. And I'm going to put Cameron on the phone with you, Alex. Hold on.
Sure. But is it back up? Or, I mean, how long do they censor it?
Hi, this is Cameron. I run the account, and it's been up for about since June 16th now, but before that we had two other accounts. This is our third one.
I understand. So as you get popular, they take it down and teach you how open and tolerant they are.
Yeah, once we start saying stuff about Hillary in particular, it gets shut down.
Well, like, the answer is to screenshot your old site, put YouTube videos up about what they did, doppelgang it with Facebook, but also your own website, as Drudge says. You must have your own platform. So they make it easy for you to go to them so they can control you. Have your own platform, your own base, that you then launch information warfare attacks with the truth into their systems. But when you go into the Matrix, you've got to jack in. You've got to have your own ship. So I'm telling you, I want you to go to the next level. I want you to start your own website. Go take a class if you need to, but they're really easy. And start pointing out that you're being censored, you're being controlled, and then listen, make it a whole career. This is the answer, what you're doing right now.
Thank you.
Anything else you'd like to add?
Thank you, sir. No, thank you. That's pretty much it.
All right, tell folks your site now while it's still up. Because they want to intimidate young people. This is how authoritarian they are.
Yeah. Exactly. My dad also says to go on to his Facebook page, The Vote Protectors.
All right. God bless you.
He's getting it started, too. All right. Thank you. You too.
Thank you. We need to see young people just out there reporting with their own video camera. Everybody just go have your own YouTube. Say, I'm out here doing, you know, exit polls. Just do it. Just do it, and we'll have eyes everywhere, and it's game over. I'm skipping this network break. Okay. He joins us. Bill Federer. William J. Federer is a nationally known speaker, best-selling author, and president of Amera Research, Inc., a publishing company dedicated to researching America's noble heritage. And they got films, documentaries, books. It's just amazing. Some of this is used in my children's schooling. Bill's America's Minute radio feature is broadcast daily across America and on the Internet. His Faith in History television airs on the TCT network on stations across America and via DirecTV, AmericanMinute.com. Bill, thank you so much for joining us.
Alex, great to be with you.
Well, Hillary's just openly stolen the nomination. They admit Sanders was the winner. You hear about all the censorship going on against patriots, just Americana folks that are classical liberals. They call us conservatives. Where would you say our republic is right now?
Well, you hit upon it when you talked about the concentrated power and then the free market, the separated power. And this is a theme that goes back to the beginning of recorded human history. So writing was invented around 3 or 4,000 BC, Sumerian, cuneiform on clay tablets in the Mesopotamian Valley. That's 3 or 4,000 BC. We're around 2080. So that's around 6,000 years of recorded human history, which is not that long. It's only 60 people living 100 years each back to back. So we're basically talking 60 grandmas, and you're all the way back to the beginning of recorded human history. But what do we see in these records? 2,000 years, 33 major Egyptian dynasties ruled by pharaohs. 5,000 years, 18 major Chinese dynasties ruled by emperors. Cyrus of Persia, Nebuchadnezzar, Darius, Alexander the Great, Indian Maharajas, Julius Caesar, the Byzantine emperors, Muslim sultans, African chieftains, King Kamehameha, and then, of course, these global empires, right? Genghis Khan killed 30 million people from Korea to Hungary, and then the King of Spain, France, and Austria. But the most powerful king in recorded history was the King of England, and he controlled 13 million square miles and a half a billion people. Now, I do point out that communism is nothing more than monarchy. Every communist country has a dictator: Stalin, Pol Pot, Ho Chi Minh, Castro, Mao Zedong. The Communist Party members.
North Korea is a hereditary dictatorship.
Yeah, and the Communist Party members are the new royalty, and then the people are the peasants. So basically, socialism, communism is a monarchy makeover. But there's this undeniable trend for power to want to concentrate. Now, our founders, when they had a chance to set up a government, they wanted to run as far away from a king as possible. They took the power of a king, broke it into three branches, separated it federal to state level, tied up this federal Frankenstein with 10 handcuffs. It was Eisenhower that used that Frankenstein term. He said the states created the federal government, but Frankenstein-like, the creature wants to destroy the creators. And so there's this trend of gravity wanting to pull the satellite back down. And so it was good that Lincoln ended slavery, but in the process, a lot of rights went from the states to the federal government. It was good that Franklin Roosevelt wanted to end the Depression, but he concentrates power with his New Deal programs. It was good that Lyndon Johnson wanted to end poverty, but he concentrates power with his welfare state and Nixon's war on drugs. And Bush, it was good he stopped more terrorist attacks, but he concentrated power with the NSA and the Patriot Act. And now the new president, no matter what the crisis is, the answer is the same. He doesn't have time to be limited by Congress. He has his pen and his phone, and he wants to concentrate power. And so this is a natural trend, but you have philosophers that actually want to speed it along. Machiavelli, Hegel, Karl Marx, Saul Alinsky. And just in a nutshell, Machiavelli lived 500 years ago in Italy. Italy was a bunch of city-states, Venice, Genoa, Naples, Florence, Siena. They all had armies and navies and fought. And Machiavelli thought if one prince could control all of Italy, it would stop this infighting. So he writes a book called The Prince, where he advocates the ends justifies the means. The end of one prince controlling all of Italy is such a good end because it'll stop this infighting that any means necessary to get there is justified. Lie, cheat, steal. So if a prince conquers a city, the city would hate him. But if the prince paid criminals to kill cows and burn barns and create crisis and terror, the people would cry out for help. The prince would come in and get rid of the very people he bribed. Nobody would know the better for it, and everyone would praise the prince as a hero. And it's actually good marketing. You create the need and fill it. You go around the back of the house and set it on fire, and then you go around the front of the house and sell them a fire extinguisher.
And that's Cloward and Piven, which has been adopted by the Democrats to bankrupt the country so they can then take it over.
Right, and they get to be the heroes in the process of taking it over. And this Machiavellian strategy influenced someone named...
And that's why they brought in 5 million radical Islamics into Europe, 80% military-age men. Now that they attack, I said this 2 years ago, now they attack, they declare civil emergency and arrest Germans and Swedes and Frenchmen that criticize the Islamic invasion. So the very government that brings it in is now the hero taking your rights but still won't fight it.
Another term that you described is called psychological projection, blame shifting, where the attacker blames the victim. So the person that is accusing the other of being racist, the accuser is actually the racist one. Somebody's saying, well, you're rich people, class warfare. Well, it's the accuser. There's a David Axelrod. I actually saw him at the Republican National Convention and said hi to him. And anyway, he was on NPR Radio 2010, and he said, in Chicago politics, we have a tradition where you throw a brick through your own campaign office window and then call a press conference to accuse your opponent.
Sure, and that later got put into House of Cards.
And, wanted to throw in Hegel really quick. Napoleon conquers Prussia, a German province, so easily that the king said, we can't let that happen again. We need to strengthen the state. And so Hegel was the philosophical basis. He says, the state is God walking on earth. And he came up with Hegelian dialectics, a way to concentrate power. And it's a triangle. One corner is a thesis, the opposite is an antithesis or antithesis, and the top corner is a synthesis.
And didn't he just codify the whole false flag of Machiavelli?
You've got it. And it sounds complicated, but it's actually simple. You start off, you create a problem that's real bad, and everybody is happy to settle for your answer that's half as bad. Then that becomes the new thesis starting point, and you create another problem that's real bad, and everybody's happy to settle for your answer that's half as bad. You do this over and over till you move from the people ruling themselves to a king. And so Karl Marx applied Hegelian dialectics to politics. How do you create a problem that's real bad? You send in organizers, agent provocateurs, provoking agents, agitators. Their goal is to find those who have grievances and tension right under the surface, and you stir them up to riot and have random killing and bloodshed, and then everybody is willing and begging some strong leader to come in and restore order.
And I don't think I've ever seen in U.S. politics since I've been alive, or just in history, period, a time when the Democratic Party particularly is literally invoking classic Hegelian dialectic destabilization program. Let me ask you if you agree with that statement, and then B, Mr. Federer, AmericanMinute.com, is it going well for them?
Well, you're hitting it right on the head, and I applaud you for speaking and explaining this to the public. I find so many people, Lenin called, he used the term useful idiots, people that are actually caught up in thinking that the issue is what they're talking about. Saul Alinsky, quote David Horowitz quoted from him, he says, the issue is never the issue. The issue is revolution. And so what Karl Marx did, he would send in these agitators, and they would organize the proletariat against the bourgeois, the working class against the business owners. They'd organize the blacks against the whites, the Muslims against the Christians, the Catholics against the Protestants, the Hutus against the Tutsis in the Congo and Rwanda. They really don't care who the two sides are, and they don't care what the issues are. They just want a destabilizing crisis that's so bad that everybody begs a strong leader. Now, it actually works best if the people are not Christian. Why? Napoleon said, religion is what keeps the poor from murdering the rich. So if you have poor Christians, they'll just forgive. They'll just, suffer. And
that's why globalists target Christians worldwide, real Christians, because they don't conform to this dialectic.
Right. And so you get these people that have raw human passion, and you say, you've been wronged. You want what they have, follow me, you'll get it. And once there's a destabilization of social order is when this strong leader usurps power. And
is that why Muslims seem to be the perfect patsies?
Well, yes, Muhammad used this tactic. He would come into a town with their scimitar swords, and they would do random violence, and the town would say, well, what do we have to do to stop you? He would say, submit. And they go, okay, well, we submit. What does that mean? Okay, men, get your sword and your horse, follow me to the next town. And so the larger group would go to the next town, and they do random violence, and the people say, what do we got to do to stop you? And they say, submit. And then you say, okay, get
so
your sword and horse.
So it's called terrorism. He's been employing terrorism for 1,400 years.
Yeah, and now there's lots of Muslims who have backslidden, but every now and then you get those wanting to follow Muhammad's example. We call that getting radicalized. And so Muhammad wrote a book how he transitioned from being a religious leader for 12 years in the pagan city of Mecca, and he is not very successful. He only makes 70 converts in 12 years. And so the people of Mecca decide that Muhammad is a disturber of the peace because he's getting confrontational. They chase him out of town. Muhammad has nowhere to go. He is a Muslim refugee. He goes 210 miles north to a Jewish city called Medina. The Jews are nice and tolerant. They let Muhammad in as a Muslim immigrant. He goes into the minority neighborhoods, and he organizes a following amongst those who have grievances against this Jewish-controlled city. And he gets a following, right, organizing in the community. And when the following's big enough, he goes to the Jews and pressures them to accommodate him and his followers politically. The Jews do, and now Muhammad is a political leader in addition to being a religious leader. Then Muhammad's followers in Mecca get confrontational, argument, threatening. They get chased out of town for disturbing the peace. They're Muslim refugees. They go to Medina, the Jewish city. They're nice. They let Muhammad's followers in as Muslim immigrants. And Muhammad allows his followers to rob the caravans headed to Mecca in retaliation for the Meccans chasing them out of town. So where Jesus said, if they take your coat, give them your shirt, Muhammad's attitude was, if they take your house, you retaliate, take their caravan. So Muhammad had 300 warriors, and they would rob caravans. He got a whole chapter of the Quran, it's Surah 8, chapter 8, on how to distribute booty from robbing
caravans.
And
then we wonder why all this is happening, and then as soon as the Muslim mayor gets elected in London, he starts restricting free speech, says he's going to ignore the law. They're following a program of conquest. Why does the left merge so seamlessly with the totalitarian Orthodox Islam, because they claim they're all liberal, but there is a love fest between the technocratic folks and Islam.
David Horowitz said that the union between the radical left and radical Islam is the most dangerous thing that's happening in our era. And so the radical left hates Judeo-Christian values. They hate the concept of the individual. They want everybody to conform to the state. And Islam hates Judeo-Christian values, and they want everybody to conform. So they sort of see themselves as partners against traditional Judeo-Christian values.
Yeah, they hate the West because it's open. They can't compete with it. So they got to blow it up and bring in their system of tyranny. They cannot compete with the free market. They cannot compete with classical liberalism.
And now, there's no honor among thieves. They don't like each other. Sort of like you see those movies where, you know, a couple bank robbers will rob the bank and they're dividing up the money. And the one pulls out a gun and shoots the other and he gets to keep all the money, right? So they don't trust each other, but they'll use each other against the West. But it is, we've always thought of communism on one side, Islam on the other side. Well, the Muslim Brotherhood is a cross-pollinization.
Wow. Bill Federer, you were on many years ago. I don't know how it fell through the cracks. You're just a superstar of history. I hope you'll start coming on routinely. Come back and let's talk more about this, and we'll take calls. Thank you, sir.
That'd be cool.
All right. Bill Federer, probably on the show four or five times over a decade ago, and then I saw him at the RNC, and it was like seeing an old cousin or somebody that you hadn't seen in forever, and you forgot what good friends you were with him. Well, in this case, I've read his books to my children. I've shown his lectures to them. I've seen him here and there on cable, heard him here and there on the radio for, gosh, it's got to be 25 years. I mean, before I was even on air, unless I'm wrong. I mean, I remember Bill Federer. And so it was just like, wow, this guy deserves to be heard because I know history. And this guy knows what he's talking about, like, squared, you know, to the next level to what I know. And I know way more than most people. And then I feel ignorant. Because history's so big, you meet this guy and read his stuff. I mean, it is dead on. And so we just talked during the break. We're going to start carrying his American Minute here on the radio and TV and also clips of his larger lectures. He's got a new book, The Rise of a Tyrant. We're going to talk about that for about 10 minutes, then go to your phone calls and let him go. But just important work, AmericanMinute.com. Now, before we go back to him, we're running the biggest sale in our history. Once a year, we do a super sale fundraiser. And we do it with 40% off great vitamins, minerals, nutraceuticals, Hillary for prison shirts, great air filters. Technology's gotten so good. It's normally about $250 for $180. Comparable units are $400 or more. I'm going to tell you, because 3 years ago, I bought units that were almost $1,000 that are basically the same. So stuff's getting less expensive, but still, most people gouge you for similar units for $400. It's $180 Alexa Pure Breeze, 20% off regular retail that is still a steal. Water filtration systems that are gravity fed, Alexa Pure Pro. No association with me. This is just the best unit out there. Those are 20% off. Pro Pure water filters that are excellent, 20% off. Infowarsstore.com or Infowarslife.com for the supplements. And again, all of those purchases make what we do here possible with the news teams, the reporters, the crew. And we are doing everything we can to just really, really bust our butts. I mean, I'll be honest. Our crew lately, the last few weeks, been working 18 hours a day, and I haven't even had to tell them to do this because they understand what's happening is so historical. And I've never had a better crew. I've had great crews over the years, you know, 20-something years, but and some crew have been here like 15 years, like Paul Watson. But they are godsends, and I am so blessed to have them. So thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support. Thank you for spreading the word. And thank you for supporting our local AM and FM affiliates and also UHF, VHF, and cable stations. Support those sponsors. Let them know why you're supporting them. Support those stations. Send them $100. They're doing everything they can to bankrupt and shut down talk radio. They're doing everything. I've been kicked off so many stations, even though we have high ratings and make stations money. The stations go, we're sorry, Alex. They came with federal money for these federally produced programs, and we need it. It's $300,000 just to take you off the 2 hours you're on the weekend. And they apologize to me. And I say, please don't, you know, say the station, but as soon as the money's gone, we'll put you back on. I mean, they're making a move against free speech. You see the censorship everywhere, but it's not stopping us. But we're one of the biggest groups, though. Little people are getting shut down because all of you together are much bigger than InfoWars or Matt Drudge. But believe me, if they can take down Fox News, there's a coup there right now, and they're doing it. Matt Drudge is next. Alex Jones is next. So I'm not complaining. I'm just telling you, we are 2 minutes to midnight here. But it's because we're having such inroads against tyranny that the enemy's moving. So we're forcing them out in the open. All right, Bill Federer, let's get into any other key points you want to make. Get into your new book. And then I want to have you back for a full hour in the next few weeks, and we really appreciate your time.
Well, human behavior is predictable. There's a saying, past behavior is the best indicator of future performance. And so that's the advantage of learning history. Now, if you take a map of Eurasia right before America was discovered, you got China on one side. And for 5,000 years, they had 18 major Chinese dynasties. And if you wanted to have a republic or a democracy, the emperor would show up with a 100,000-man army and rip the walls down around your city. So China has really never had any experiments in self-government. The other side of the map is the Mediterranean. And you've got islands and rocks and storms. And it's very hard to have a dictatorship with all these variables. And so it's in the islands of the Mediterranean we see the next step of people experimenting.
Because there's places to hide. There's places to hide.
Right. And so if we focus on Athens, around 622 BC, Athens had a king named Draco, and he had Athens' first written laws. Now, this was a step up because prior kings could rule on their whims and caprices, and they'd kill you and take your farm. And so the people of Athens says, look, King Draco, at least write these laws down. He did, but it was the death penalty for every other thing. So they got nicknamed Draconian laws. That's where that term came from. Well, in 594 BC, they get a new king in Athens named Solon. S-O-L-O-N. Solon invented democracy. And in democracy, everybody every day had to go to the market and talk politics. And if you didn't keep up with politics every day in Athens, you were called an idiotus, an idiot. And now if there's a king, an emperor, and you have an agenda, you got to get in to see the guy. Like China, the emperor had 2,000 concubines and Mandarin eunuchs that kept them, and you'd bribe these Mandarins with money just to get in to pitch your agenda. Well, in Athens, there was no emperor. The people made the decisions. Well, if you have an agenda, how do you pitch it to the whole city? They would get the whole city together in an amphitheater and put on plays, comedies, and tragedies where they'd ridicule and buffoon certain points of view and honor and extol other points of view.
And this brought in high culture.
And from that time till now, theater and entertainment is always political in a country where it's the people making the decisions. And I could get into more of that, but someone I wanted to mention is Plato. Now, he lived in the Athenian democracy, and he said the government would go through five stages. The first stage, he said, was rule of the capable. These are people that know how to run farms and businesses. They know how to run city government. They're just responsible. They do a good job. The city grows. The second group wants to get involved in politics. Plato called them lovers of fame. And these are people that may be a Greek actor and are a Greek Olympic athlete. Everybody knew their name, and they get involved in politics not because they have responsible experience running a business, but because they were famous. Maybe like a Hollywood action figure that gets elected governor of California. You think, what did Lee Arnold run before he became governor? Nothing. He was just famous. Now, these famous people like fame, and they hate being defamed. So these you can manipulate with public opinion. So the first ones, they're going to do what's right because they're responsible. The second ones, they'll bend. And so the second group begins to yield to the human tendency of avarice, selfishness, and they vote a little money out of the city treasury to pad their retirement. They're working hard after all. They vote a little money to their brother-in-law's construction company, a little money to some supporter that can funnel it back into their campaign, and it turns into a third category, which Plato called lovers of money. It's an oligarchy. It's a rule of few. It's an insider clique, and if you're friends with the people that are inside, you get the pork projects and all the extra, you know.
And so productivity starts going down, so now things aren't going as well. Now the fourth stage.
And so it turns into this division in society, and the people finally throw the bums out and set up a democracy. This is the fourth stage. And in a democracy, everybody learns how to tolerate each other. It's great. They tolerate, you know, all kinds of behavior. Then they tolerate people that are a little bit off. Then they tolerate people that are a lot off, till finally they're tolerating open crime and convicts and all kinds of immorality. And Plato even says this, the manner of life is that of Democrats. That's his word because he's describing a democracy. Every man does what is right in their own eyes. The young man gives into libertinism and useless and unnecessary pleasures, even incest and unnatural union. Yeah, that's what he's talking about. And they throw off restraint. And it's just anything goes. And then they raid the city treasury, and now there's a shortage. And they say, where can we get more money? The rich people. They tax it from the rich people.
So in comes the tyrant.
And then it turns into this chaos. They don't have they have a shortage. And, well, don't cut back on what I'm used to getting. And it turns into this tug of war and anarchy. And then they begin to say, can't someone come along and fix this mess? And that's the fifth stage. Someone comes along, Plato calls him. First, he appears above ground as the protector. And he's very eloquent and persuasive and gives these great speeches. And people fall in love with him. And then they notice he's beginning to concentrate power too much. And he loses in the public opinion polls. And they cast it in his teeth that he's getting too powerful. And he has a choice. Give up the power, which he's not inclined to do, because Plato called him a lover of power. Or get rid of the people confronting him. So he purges his military and his administration of anybody that has virtue. He doesn't want people with virtue. He wants yes men. And then who does he get to be his new friends now that he got rid of the old ones? He frees the slaves, the convicts, the criminals, the illegal aliens, and he arms them, and they become his mob that he sends around to punish anybody that disagrees with him politically. And so here's what Plato wrote. And the protector of the people, having a mob entirely at his disposal, he is not restrained from shedding the blood of kinsmen by the favorite method of false accusations. He brings them into court and murders them. And so he uses this power of the state to go after his political enemies. And finally, he stands in the chariot of state, holding the reins of power, and he's revealed as the tyrant.
And then over time, the society declines. But the weird thing about Plato is, and I've read his Republic and other writings, and of course, he's the model of everything today, is it's very dual, because he'll admit all this bad stuff, but then talk about eugenics and getting rid of masses of people because we're crushing the breast of the earth. And then, you know, he also pushed some really tyrannical stuff because he understands all of this. He talks about Plato's cave and, you know, how we're controlled. I mean, it's all genius, obviously. But I don't know if duality is the word or the paradox of Plato. Can you speak to that, Bill Federer?
Right. He said that democracy is a temporary form of government because people really don't have virtue. If they're given the choice of giving up their virtue or giving up their life.
So you have to have a republic that guards certain codes so the mob can't vote the other half be their slaves.
Right. And so he says the best you can hope for is a nice tyrant. And he called him a philosopher king. But then he says this. He says, the tyrant, then comes the famous request for a bodyguard with his, in other words, there's threats on this tyrant's life, and the people are all concerned about him, and they let him. This is a false coup. This is like what happened in Turkey, right? And so there's this threat on the guy's life. And, you know, Sergei Kirov is a famous Russian that was praising Stalin. And Stalin was a little threatened by him because he was getting too popular. But Stalin also had another problem of these anti-Stalinists. And so Stalin had an idea. He would murder his friend, Sergei Kirov. Nobody would blame him because they're such close friends. And everybody would blame these anti-Stalinists. And so he murders them, blames it on the anti-Stalinists, uses that as an excuse to purge the Soviet Union of over 1 million people. And so this is this staged coup type of thing.
Bill Federer, absolutely. That's exactly what we're talking about now that's happened in Turkey. Expanding on that then, looking at this, what phase would you say we're in right now? Because obviously these phases are in flux. Things are so complex now. There's pieces of every phase. Thomas Jefferson first, you know, he talked about the yeoman farmer. He said we've got to stay decentralized. We've got to stay local, and we've got to stay near the earth or we'll become decadent slobs. He believed, as a classical liberal, that that was the way to basically short-circuit this slouch towards Gomorrah. Can you speak to that as a historian?
Well, when the public opinion of the quote-unquote protector begins to go down, then he throws off the charade. Why try to give this fake front that he's in favor of the people? He just throws it off and he becomes a dictator. And so it's like a cornered animal. And when they really get in the corner, the fangs come out. And if we think, oh, Republicans get a turn, Democrats get a turn. We're talking global power. We're talking the 6,000-year quest.
Now, Hillary may openly steal the election. I mean, she is already stole the nomination. She's already committing crimes. She's already by the law. She is a tyrant ready delivered. I believe if she's put in office, she will become Tyrannus Maximus.
She's would extract retribution on all those that disagree with her. It's sort of like electrons. What we're seeing is it's a struggle. Is it power from the bottom up or power from the top down? You know, King Louis the 14th was called the Sun King, and his subjects were the planets that revolved around him. Louis the 14th said, "I am the state," and he even said, "It is the law because I wish it." Lo and behold, the law was just the king's will.
So let it be written, so let it be done.
In America, we said, we don't like that. We want law from the bottom up. And so what we're experiencing right now is this electronic polarity struggle. Is it going to be...
So you agree, we're in a galactic crossroads of flux point. Which way do you see the tea leaves going?
I have to look at it from somewhat of a spiritual perspective to get any hope. And it's, what stories do we like in the Bible? Well, it's David against Goliath. It's Moses against Pharaoh. It's, you know, Gideon against 100,000 men. In other words, it looks hopeless. And then little nobodies with faith and courage stand up and things turn around. And that's what I'm hoping for and praying for. If I looked at it strictly from the natural, you'd think, gee, from Nimrod and the Tower of Babel to Genghis Khan, Attila the Hun, these empires keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger, clearly with a global perspective as an ultimate goal. You know, the George Soros wanting to, and so this.
And by the way, you know, George Soros is proud of his Nazi collaborating, 60 Minutes, and I've read his writings where he says he believes he's a messiah and a Christ. He's clearly a megalomaniac mental patient. I mean, why isn't he locked up?
Well, I mentioned before that I lived in Missouri. I was half an hour from Ferguson. 99% of the people rioting in Ferguson were not from Ferguson. They were all brought in, part of the old Occupy Wall Street people, but it was more Missourians organizing for reform and empowerment. And you can go to Snopes, and it even says it's a George Soros-funded group. He put $30 million into it, and they organized the rioters. They actually advertise in Chicago papers, you know, go to Missouri and organize. And
not to empower black people, but make them be the detonator switch to bring in tyranny, and then they'll get the blame.
Yeah, I mean, the mayor of Ferguson worked on my campaign when I ran for Congress back in the year 2000. I ran against Dick Gephardt. And so the scenario is you have a Democrat governor that tells the National Guard to stand down and let them riot for 3 days till it makes national news. Then you say our local police departments are inadequate. We need to federalize them. Strong Cities Initiative, shared data with the federal government, and then the same people were moved to Baltimore. It's a rent-a-mob, and the Democrat mayor lets them do $1 billion worth of damage, and afterwards they say our local police department's inadequate. We need to federalize it. And so they're going 53 cities now, Denver, Colorado, and they're coming in, setting oversight. And basically, it's giving the federal government, Department of Justice, Homeland Security, control over the local police departments. In other words, it's giving the president a standing army.
Bill, I tell you, I really want to get you back for a full hour in the near future. I'm going to go to break and take a few calls here for folks that have been holding. Really amazing, AmericanMinute.com. I'm really excited to hear you're going to join us once a month on the radio, once a month on the nightly news, and talk about all the books you've written and the e-books and the DVDs and the fiction. This is something everybody, in fact, I've given this to my children years ago. I'm like, wow, Bill Federer, I've got to go get all, I'm not just pitching this, it's true, folks. I mean, he's not a sponsor, I'm really doing this. I've got to go get some more of your audio CDs and MP3 files for my children. They love this type of information. My daughters and my son, they're so informed because of your work and others. And so there's just so many great jewels like yourself out there. And I hope that people will go get these materials and really discover that humans live 75 years on average, as the Bible says. And we all think we're really different, but at the end of the day, we all kind of do the same stuff over and over again. And there are manipulators who know this knowledge but use it against people. And just knowing real psychology, real history, history is real psychology. That's an Alex Jones quote. History is real psychology, not pop disinformation. And if you know it, you know how we act. Just in business, knowing history, knowing human nature, I'm so much more successful in the fight for liberty. And I just wish the general public knew that knowing history gets you ahead, not behind. 30 seconds, Bill Federer.
Well, I just want to thank you for having the courage to bring all this to light. And, you know, I think you're one of the ones that's being raised up to educate our country. And there's always hope, but there's something for every single person to do. You know, our founders flipped it, and they made the people the king and the politicians the servants. And so those that are listening to this program, you're the king. The politicians are your
servants.
That's
right. And if we throw that away, we deserve to be slaves. Bill, have a great weekend. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
We'll be talking to Bill Federer very soon. Your call straight ahead in the fourth hour with Rob Dude. Infowars.com. I have personally pledged that. And I tell you, when you actually pledge something and then you do it, there's something spiritual, interdimensional that happens. The universe opens up. And providence begins to rear its head. And then the real magic starts. Unfortunately, most people turn themselves into pawns. I don't want to be a pawn. I don't want you to be a pawn. I want you to be successful. I want you to be free. And then I want you to treat me with respect as well. You look at the slaves of the Democrats, and the Republicans are horrible as well. But you notice the Republicans didn't go along with stealing the nomination. There's more virtue there just because of the top people that support it, not the leadership. And you look at the minions of the Democrats, even when they mean well, these people are broken. They're fallen. And it's because that's how the system wants them. We can't look at those people and get them power trips and go, boy, look how smart we are compared to them. And no. Because their falling brings us down with them. Hillary Clinton is so manifestly disingenuous, so openly corrupt, so sickeningly narcissistic, so explosively evil. She's filled with demonic criminal energy. And let me tell you something, folks. Forget worshiping police. Everybody knows that's not where I come from. I want to reform them. There's big problems. The whole government's got problems. But the police are the whipping child of all the corrupt nastiness that makes them look like choir boys. And the fact that we've all been conditioned now. Some more cops got executed. Whatever. Nobody knows their names. Nobody cares. It's kind of blah, blah, blah. I mean, I know the names of the black guys getting shot. I don't know the names of the cops. And that's because the media does, you know, I read it once or twice. It's just an example of, I am falling to their conditioning. That's just an example of Hillary openly stealing the nomination. And I'm pretty calm about it. People think I'm a freak for getting upset about it. They openly steal elections now for the first time ever, and it's no big deal? Yeah, I mean, she's got a freaking hyena. And they censored it when people made this video? It's like, she laughs like an evil clown in a poltergeist. What's really sick is she always brags about killing people and how good she is at killing people. And then she's like a wimp and can hardly walk. It's like even more ridiculous. Like, the more accomplished the killer is, the more humble they are, in my experience. You get around, though, these little waddling, like, Kim Jong-un people. I mean, she's a Kim Jong-un, man. Just an insulated, entitled, demonic, pus-filled, just freakazoid with all of her little freakazoid, sycophantic wimps around her. And here's the thing, though, that's worse. We're ruled by this garbage. I'm going to go to break, come back and do 20 minutes or so with Rob News coming in. With Brian and Todd and Gera and James and Blackburn. I'm going to get to everybody. James has been holding the longest than Brian and others and Todd. But don't forget, we are listener supported. We're not perfect, but we love liberty. We're committed. And yes, we're crazy maniacs when it comes to fighting these people. I want to be the opposite of these folks, okay? And I am, quite frankly. I got a huge conscience. I absolutely am super emotional. And I also love to take on thugs, and I need the funding and support to do it. Buy the products, the huge sale going throughout the weekend. Thank you for your support, InfoWarsStore.com. Stay with us. We'll be back at 70. By the way, by the end of the hour, they're going to post, I'm told, some of the Twitter entries for the Hillary is a great white shark cresting, because there's that photo of her like, and I want to put that out. Somebody else did one. We get sent a lot of other cool stuff of Hillary as a NASCAR racer, race car driver with Chase Bank and Goldman Sachs and everybody that funds her. So that's pretty hilarious up on Infowars.com. Here's the big news I'm going to cover before I leave and Rob Dew takes over from the other studio. We've got proof Twitter is now censoring Donald Trump completely. Google won't even list him as a presidential candidate. I mean, they're going to steal the election. He's 7 to 10 points ahead. I will not put up with this crap. The government is illegitimate at the moment. And I'm going to tell the police and military something. I've never gotten into this fetish with military coups. I'm going to tell you something right now. Thank you, Nico. Are we going to let them steal the election while they promote going and shooting cops in the back? I always say I want to fix stuff peacefully, and I'm not planning anything offensively myself. It's not much more effective informationally, but at a certain point, you got to quit putting up with the crap. I mean, this is getting ridiculous. And then people I talk to will go, that's the whole point, Alex. We're kicking their butt in the info war. You know, I understand that. But I mean, at a certain point, it's like some communist hit me in the side and hit me in the shoulder and I rammed into him. I mean, it's just instinctive. Like four of them like fell over. They're just these little chicken neck pieces of crap. And I'm so sick of it. I'm sick of these cowards. We're being overrun. We're being overrun by every form of scum. I mean, we have all these crazy weirdo feminists who've never been in the military trying to start war with Russia and China and putting jihadis in everywhere. And he won't even let Christian refugees in, so they get killed. I mean, it's just like, wow, really out to get us. I just want a leader that isn't out to get the country. I just want somebody that doesn't hate me because I'm a gun owner or a Christian. I am a bitter clinger. All right, I said I'd go to your phone calls. Let's just hold the longest here. That'd be a California caller, Brian. Brian, you're on the air. Thanks for holding.
Hey, Alex, God bless, and, you know, Godspeed to you and the whole InfoWars team, man.
Thank you.
Hey, you know, I want to plug the products also. I didn't call in for that reason, but I can't say enough great things about them.
Thank you.
You know, really across the board, top of the line. Everybody.
We do set out to bring you the lowest price nutraceutical that are either missing links or game changers or staples from major brands, private labeled at a lower price.
Absolutely. They're amazing. So continue the good work there.
Thank you.
Hey, look, man, this is what concerns me right now. And this is why I think it's a time when everybody sort of has to stand up and voice their sort of their belief in what's right and wrong right now. The reason I call is, you know, we're looking at the first debate on September 26th. So we're not even 2 months out, right? And, you know, I've worked in the high technology game for about the last 10 years, and I understand that there's the algorithms that they can sort of look at to check the pulse of what the nation is thinking, right? And my concern is right now, the mainstream media is having to admit that Donald Trump is up at least 7.5 points. In reality, that's probably 15 or 20%, right? So,
well, let's be conservative. With closeted folks, my analysis is 10 to 11 points, and I can tell you that the insiders were shocked by that, you know, top pollsters saying that's our number. Well, I know how to dead reckon. I mean, I'm a man of the street, and I can tell you, here's the deal. I think it would be higher if a lot of the folks are on the fence like Trump. They're not going to vote. They need to go vote. They need to register right now. They need to vote. Everybody, just to support free speech and the right of elections, you must vote Donald Trump.
Alex, you know, I've been to the think tanks. I've sat in the strategy sessions. People don't understand what is at stake. You do a great job, you know, sort of, you know, ringing the alarm and bringing people to the table and exposing information, but people don't really understand.
Well, Brian, tell us what's at stake, because I interrupted you for the 2 minutes you were on. But come back, shut up for 2 minutes, give me the floor and everybody else, and then Anthony Gugiardi might come in here and join me. We got Rob Dew coming up as well. I don't want to leave. I'm going to broadcast for 28 hours more. I mean, it's just... I've never had more energy. This is so historic. I'm not up here trying to hype this like it's exciting. It's so exciting. I don't know how to, like, describe how exciting it is. I mean, it's just, whoa. I mean, this is incredible. We got the truth. It's the hydrogen bomb of weapons. We are using it. And you see the effects. The thinking people are listening. I was out there watching Fox News during the break, and they're like, Trump hasn't responded to the speeches last night. His tweet said Hillary carries destruction and corruption and lies behind her. It's all a fraud. He put out countless tweets about how she's a sellout. I mean, they're up on Infowars.com. But I have to tell you, Trump is playing this very, very fair while Hillary stole the nomination. If I was Trump, He's already really been aggressive, but I would do stuff like during the DNC, I'd have just been live during the speeches every night with the press conference. I'd say they're crooked. They stole the nomination. It's all illegitimate. So I'm just up here talking about how they're crooked and how they stole the election. And here's some clips of the superdelegates admitting they were going to steal it. I mean, every time he does that, he goes up in the polls. And I know his general advisors tell him, back off. But now I hear his general advisors sounding like yours truly and sounding like Roger Stone, because that's the truth. When you're faced with outrageous corruption, outrageous, over-the-top, redonkulous garbage, the only response back is to say it's ridiculous. I mean, when she steals a nomination, she stole it. We're not the radicals here. I want to explain that. Every time a cop gets their head blown off or shot in the back, just randomly, black cops, white cops, you name it, just by crazy people, the president goes, the police better reform themselves, and Hillary says they better listen up. That takes all this to a whole nother level now, folks. This government is in active terrorism against our local governments and the American people. And make no mistake, you can get mad at cops, revenue generating, or arrogant cops, and Lord knows they're there, and I'm the guy that opposes that. But not because I hate them or want to kill people. Just because there's a bad cop and I'm against him doesn't mean I'm some maniac who wants to kill innocent people. They wouldn't be doing stuff like this unless they're thinking about overthrowing everything. And I mean cities burning and just the end, folks, of this country. Or at least for a while, it's going to be hellish. Because here's the deal. Patriots aren't going away. And we're not looking for trouble. And we don't shoot our mouths off. But let me just say, everybody pushing this mass murder crap and all this other crazy sedition, you better believe you shouldn't be worried about Alex Jones, but the veterans and the police officers, they are going to clean your clock when the veneer comes back. And they don't want to do that, but believe me, you think you're doing all this in a vacuum and that you are immune, you better think twice. And everybody knows I don't make threats. And I'm not intending myself to do anything except stand here and carry out the truth and warn people. I'm doing the main job of exposing these people, and you are doing the main job. But, man, let me tell you, they have gone super weaponized. The globalists have escalated to levels I didn't think they'd be doing right now. I thought it was later, which means they've moved their timetable up. Just got chills. Oh, my God. Whoa. I mean, Rob, dude, I'm going to go back to calls here and then go to you doing the fourth hour. You've been working 17 days straight. We just talked during the break. I haven't told you to do that. You want to do it for your family. You've been here, you know, 8 years or whatever. Some folks, 15 years, like Paul Watson. I mean, do you disagree with me that the energy level, both on good and bad, has now reached just epic crescendo level?
Yeah, it's the quickening. Like you said, it starts off going real slow like that, and all of a sudden it ramps up. And I think we're in that ramp-up phase where it's about to go supernova. And it's on both sides. The awakening's happening on both sides. I mean, Bernie people are waking up to the corruption. You know, Trump people are waking up to the corruption. And then you've still got these diehard groups on both sides that are just trying to keep the system going along and pretending like nothing's really happening and that anybody who steps out and says anything is a crazy conspiracy theorist. But you're talking about cops. This morning, San Diego police shooting. SWAT team surrounds home after one officer killed, another one shot and in surgery right now. So the war on police is still intensifying. And then you got Breitbart reporting.
And again, it is a war. It's a war on stability for destabilization.
Exactly. And now Black Lives Matter is going back to resume protests in Dallas after the massacre of police. So, and they were jeering during a moment of silence during the Democratic National Convention.
Now we got that clip. We haven't played that. Can we cue that up? Jeering when they put a woman cop up there, police chief, and say, you know, because it backfired, having no American flags, having Black Lives Matter up there with no cops. So then they try it, and there's such a, I mean, these are government lovers, but then they hate the cops.
Exactly.
Except they call the cops.
Right. And what's going to happen is the cops aren't going to show up to your community when something goes down, or they're going to wait and let it happen.
And then the good cops are sick of it. They're going to get out, and then they're going to get their little globalist bureaucrats in. Let's go ahead and play that clip from last night. Here it is.
Please help me, in honor of all of American fallen officers, with a moment of silence.
Thank you.
I am privileged to introduce to you.
So they stopped the moment of silence. People yelled blankly. And that's Lupe Valdez, the Dallas County Sheriff. The Dallas police let us, when the judge said no free speech, we said we're going here by the 40th. Dallas police did their job protecting us. Then after the thing was all over, just here come 50 Dallas Sheriff's Department, those basically all like Democrats, bouncers, to attack us, including children. The Dallas police were blown away but stood there, and it was Lupe Valdez and the Democrats. So, I mean, that woman is a monster.
And but, those people were deputized, Alex. They were. It seemed like that day they just deputized some people, got some local thug bouncers from the area, and said, get on in there.
Definitely like big. Everybody was like 6'5".
Big and fat. Oh, it was disgusting. I think even David Knight said, look at that fat pig. One of those guys that was just like roly-polying over there pushing people.
Well, my point is, here she is. The one cop they have up there is this little Reconquista communist.
Well, that's the way they play. That's the way they play.
It's ball. Incredible. All right, I'm going to go to some calls and let you take over. Finishing up with Brian in California. You were trying to get into the products. I interrupted you. You're trying to make another point about election time. Go ahead.
Look, you know, Alex, when you take into consideration that there is an end to this financial disaster that we're facing, not only in this country, but around the world, and then you take into the events of the job numbers reports, the precious metal manipulation, the Deutsche Bank numbers that just came out, the Italian banks needing another bailout.
The world is teetering on the edge of collapse.
There has to be an end to this, and they know. But the thing that the American people don't know is there's a system that's already in place to clamp down on you harder than you have ever thought in your life, and it's already in place. So that anything can start, and, you know, it could be a false flag. You know, us obviously trying to start a war over in Russia over a bunch of, obviously, allegations that probably aren't founded. Obviously, we have the problems at home. So, again, I laughed because people were saying how dark Trump's speech was. I thought it was fantastic. And the thing that people don't understand is as dark as things are, like you always say, there's the level of Newtonian physics that we have to acknowledge. There is a force behind this right now that they cannot stop, and that is scaring them. It's making them desperate. So that's why I'm saying Trump cannot be on a debate stage with Hillary Clinton, because he exposes her too much. But on top of that, he exposes her handlers too much.
Well said, my friend. I appreciate your call, Brian. I'm going to jump to others now. Todd in Michigan, thanks for holding her on the air.
May God bless all you say and do, Alex Jones.
Thank you.
I would like to change the playbook up a little from what you've been talking about today and let Alex Jones do what Alex Jones does and let Donald Trump kind of sink back a while and figure out who all the real players are, you know? It's time to get biblical. I mean, somebody's not reading the playbook here. And I know Trump grew up listening to Norman Vincent Peale, so he's got it in him. So I think we need to change up the playbook a little there and just go biblical. And I'm not going to quote scripture, but I did send an email.
Well, I don't mind if you quote scripture. I mean, look, my issue is, obviously, I have a huge, large audience of patriots, kind of the core of the populist resistance here in America. You're it. It's not me. I'm just one of you. I mean, obviously, Trump hears from us. We talk to Trump. I'm going to stop right there because the media makes a big thing out of it. And, you know, here's the deal. I could get Trump back on right now. But then it's my decision, really, and I'm kind of thinking, is that good or is that bad? I'm not sure, so I'm kind of leaving it alone. It's not about my show. It's about defeating Hillary. So I don't really know overall what Trump should do. He's a pretty smart guy. I think he should come out and just expose that Hillary already stole the nomination, so she'll steal anything. But you talk about biblical, he should come out just like Ben Carson did and say, this is satanic. I mean, Hillary pledged allegiance to Lucifer, basically.
Well, like the last caller said, you know, he's shown his hand too much. He needs, you know, there's a lot of people out there that don't like the way he says things, even though he's telling the truth.
Well, they're a bunch of whining dumbasses because the entire establishment is after Trump. So if you claim you're against the establishment and you want our industry back and you don't want to be a poor dumbass, you should vote for Donald Trump. I mean, it's so obvious. Right. The whole system hates him. They're probably going to kill him. I just hope all the jackasses out there, when they blow his plane up or shoot him, remember they were dumbasses.
Well, you know, we need to educate the ones that aren't awake, and we need to put the ones that are awake to work.
I hear you, and I appreciate your call, Todd. Yeah, people need to go vote. They need other people to vote. They need to be talking about the corruption. They need to get the articles at InfoWars.com about election fraud and Hillary being a scammer and Twitter censoring him and Google. I mean, they're just blocking him on Twitter, Google, everywhere, where he doesn't even exist. And he's ahead of Hillary. I mean, this is in America, in our election, open meddling. Congress, the Republicans should be hauling the head of Twitter and Facebook in right now. I'm going to go back to calls, but Rob Dew, I mean, this is crazy level censorship. People go, well, so what? That's just Trump. If they can do it to Trump, you know Drudge is next.
Well, and I have an interview that one of our newer production members, Gabe Golddiamond, got out and at the DNC, and it's a makeup artist. She's somebody who works with these people all the time. And he said, you know, what do you think? What if you tried to search Hillary Clinton's name as a presidential candidate and it didn't come up? You think that's a big deal? She's like, I don't know. And he goes, well, you know, actually what's going on right now is when you search the name Donald Trump presidential candidate, this was happening 2 days ago, and nothing comes up. And she goes, so? Like, it's no big deal. Like, and she goes, they're a private company. They can do what they want.
Oh, yeah. They hold out they're giving you a real search, but they're not telling you there's a presidential candidate. I mean, that's like the Soviet Union. You have a newspaper that won't tell you who the candidates are.
Exactly. But, you know, she's just a symptom of modern America is just like, so?
Because they think they're with the power structure. They've got power. They are chumps.
Yeah.
And when people have this attitude, the system has no respect. We've had wealth because the system was afraid of the people and because we had freedom comparatively.
Yeah.
It doesn't, you know, here's the good news. Smart, hardworking people always do okay. Unless there's a nuclear war. All these jackasses that have been wanting to go along with this, they're the ones that are screwed.
Exactly.
I mean, they have no idea how screwed they are. I mean, it is just, I mean, wow. Wow. This is beyond Pravda, you know, 1960. I mean, this is just classic. We never have any excuse to talk about, you know, communist countries or Nazis or whatever with their censorship when we now are beyond it. But there's a paradox. There's censorship going on, but then there's still freedom outside of it. Next phase is they're coming after us, dude.
Yeah, that is. And what I think is amazing is that all these leftists complain and bitch about the government and the stealing and all this and the corruption, yet their solution is more government. It's like, well, we'll give the government more power, but it'll be a nice, benevolent government. No, it doesn't work like that. It never works like that, ever, ever, ever. Just your last guest was talking about how there were thousands of years of Chinese dictators and Mongolian dictators and Egyptian dictators. It doesn't change. They weren't benevolent to their people. They never are. They give the people enough just to get by. And when the United States is the only country where you had true freedom, and that's why you have people building boats out of trash to get here.
That's right. James in Texas. James, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to lend credence to the fact that everybody keeps saying that Hillary stole Bernie Sanders, stole the convention. She didn't steal anything. Bernie Sanders gave it to her.
No. I agree, but she stole the popular vote. Look, that's why I don't say she stole it from Sanders. Sanders was a shill the whole time, stood down. We knew he'd do it. Dirtbag that he is. But the people that voted in election law, they were robbed, and the delegates were robbed. They wouldn't go along. The superdelegates took it. And so you're absolutely right that Sanders is a party to it, but she did steal the votes.
Right. He was controlled opposition from the beginning. And so I think it's imperative right now that the Republicans and Donald Trump and you and I and everybody reach out to the Bernie Sanders reporters as soon as possible, because it got out of control. You know, this plan from the beginning for to energize their base with somebody who was promising stuff that, you know, was not even close to being possible was just a
They wanted a bunch of communists and socialists and people and well-meaning leftist populists to go vote, to get them into the database, into the game, knowing Hillary couldn't even do that. Yes, it was all planned behind closed doors with Sanders. He is a total Benedict Arnold. He is Judas Iscariot.
But we need to educate his voters and his people that that's what happened, because they don't understand that. They just think that it was fraud. They think that Bernie was for them. They don't realize that he was for Hillary from day one.
And that's why they tell him to sit there and act mad when Hillary talks about him. It's all, that guy is such a dirtbag. He thinks he's smarter than you. He's preying on you and your family. He's the smart guy. Bernie Sanders is a demon. I agree with you, James. Thank you. Rob, do your take on that.
I don't think he's qualified either, Alex.
You kids, get out of here. You're on detention for a year. You know, he was the voice of the principal, maybe some butthead.
Exactly.
Gara in California, you're on the air. Welcome.
Hi, I'm an info warrior princess.
anti-worldwide womb war hag Hillary, her sinus, who chose a M-A-N man as a VP.
Sure. I mean, look, it's all a gimmick. I don't care if it's a man or a woman as long as they're a patriot. Do you think Hillary's going to try to steal the election? She already stole the nomination.
Yes. The movie Hillary's America sets the facts and educates about this whole theft of our country. And we need entrance guards documenting the groups of illegal aliens that are paid and bust into
the agree.
Pool.
It's totally criminal. I appreciate your call. Let's go ahead and go to Daniel. Daniel in Wisconsin, you're on the air worldwide on this Friday edition. Go ahead.
Hello, Alex.
Yes, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Well, special thanks to all the info warriors out there and everybody. I won't be too long with that. So I just want to touch on what's going on locally. I'm a student, an adult student at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and we're seeing programs come out related to cultural competency. And I want to say, you know, I'm working on getting this done locally and I'm getting this issue fixed and resolved.
Sure, but you're not taught about science and math or business or networking. You're taught about obsessing over culture and ninnying.
It's about terminology and language. Specifically, they want to frame it like this. What are the terminology that people need to know about in order to talk about race and racism? That in itself can be a secondary message by choosing what terms they want to include and exclude. So I've been working with an organization called thefire.org. And if you have any listeners out there who are a college students and info warriors, and they have similar issues, check out that organization. They're very, very successful at putting pressure on universities that are rolling out these kind of programs.
Absolutely. We should really put pressure because, look, some college degrees are worth something, engineering, things like that, but 80%+ of them are totally worthless, and the real answer is just let them collapse. Don't go to them, or if you're there, do it as just a political thing to try to document inside these brainwashing centers what's going on. I appreciate your call. Look, I'm out of time. I'm going to hand the baton to Rob Dew. He's got a lot of news coming up. I'm sure he'll probably take some more of your calls. Very briefly, I want to thank the viewers. I want to thank the listeners. I want to thank the sponsors. I want to thank the affiliates. I want to, as I end this main week here and hand the baton, the Nightly News is tonight, 7 o'clock as well. I want to thank you all for your support, your prayers. This is history happening. And we've had this sale the last few days that we're extending through the weekend. Some of the products are selling out, so some of the products won't be available tomorrow, but most of them will be available through Sunday. 40% off super high-quality swearable food. That's not 40% off, you know, something that was jacked up in price. That's 40% off already the lowest prices of the highest quality food you're going to find anywhere. We've got 40% off super high-quality colloidal silver, silver bullet, 40% off the nootropics, $17.76. Similar nootropics are like $60, $70. It's already a good deal at $29.95. It's $17.76. That is selling out. InfoWarsLife.com for the nutraceuticals and supplements, or InfoWarsStore.com for the umbrella side of Hillary for President and the Hillary, Bill Clinton rape shirt, or 20% off great elf air filter systems, 20% off water filtration systems, 20% off all the other T-shirts, the Molon Labe, the Come and Take It, the Molon Labe ball caps. And it's so heartening, so exciting, so invigorating to travel around the country anywhere. Not just our events, but see people wearing the shirts or similar shirts. I love seeing knockoffs of them all. I mean, that's what's really exciting. Like more than half the Hillary for President shirts weren't ours out there. That is amazing. And it just lets people know the power of the Liberty Movement and that we're growing. We've got the establishment's attention. Great job. This is true Americana, worldwide, true grassroots. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, or 888-253-3139. And again, as I said, Lord willing, I take nothing for granted. I'll be back this Sunday in studio, 4 to 6 p.m. But there's another 30 minutes of Rob Dew. The Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock. I'll be filing special reports throughout the weekend, but take advantage of the biggest sale in our history. It's the InfoWars.com Super Sale, 28-hour broadcast, and, of course, fundraiser. We have little donation buttons if you want to just give a straight-up donation, but I'd rather you get a high-quality product that enriches you and also helps us fight the globalist. Rob Du, thank you for all you do. You go ahead and take over, my friend.
Sure, and I just want to point out the guy from Madison was talking about all the terminology they have to use. I have two videos that I shot going on interviewing people out at these in these young college towns. One,
I am a binary female male of the 7th, 9th, quarter of the 14th galaxy of the 19th Kumba.
They have a dictionary of terms. One of them is drunk Bernie supporters run amok, but the one here, Bernie socialists worship capitalist products. This young lady right here, if y'all can pull it up on screen, she had the terminology down, and she sat there and talked in circles for literally 5 minutes.
It's
and
all just her like, own weird little cult about gibber.
I forgot my own question. It is.
Well, let's play some of these. I mean, these videos are gold. The new age Skrillex, the new Carl the Cuck, it's all there for you. A meme goldmine.
It is.
We need to use satire to ridicule all this. We're going to be right back with Rob Du. I'm signing off. I'm gonna go get some rest now. I hope do you gonna get some rest from this today?
I'm gonna try to get some rest. It's gonna be a good weekend.
All right, here you're going tubing. All right, I'm gonna try to go with you.
We're on the march. The Empire's on the run.
We'll be back.
Alex Jones and the GCN Radio
the
Network.
The fight is now.
So during the break, Alex and I were just looking at the myriad of YouTube videos that have been put up over the weekend by our hardworking crew out at the DNC. It was Joe Biggs, Kit Daniels, David Knight, Michael Zimmerman, Gabe Golddiamond, and others were out there. Richard Reeves was out there helping provide technical support. And just the sheer amount of stuff in there, it's hard to go. Like, we're good at really putting it out there, and it's really great when other people grab this stuff and reuse it and take the best parts out of them. Like, if you look this, are Democrats really this stupid? That was Josh Owens taking a couple different videos from the DNC that we put out and then fusing them together. Getting these people when they put their foot in their mouth and just showing how they do it. So it's a really effective way. Now, this first video I want to go to, this is with Gabe Golddiamond talking to a makeup artist. It's called Coward Makeup Artist Says Just Accept Globalism. And it's just amazing. This lady doesn't care about anything. She's here working, you know, in the Democratic National Convention and doesn't have a political care or thought in the world and thinks that, you know, open theft is okay. So let's roll that video.
Would you mind telling us what your role is and what you're here for today?
I'm here to do makeup.
Oh, okay, that's cool. Now, what if I told you that Trump's campaign was attacking Hillary's campaign through Google, and if you try to search presidential candidate Hillary Clinton, that nothing comes up? What do you think should be done about that?
Who cares?
Okay, well, that's good because that's actually not true. What's actually happening is that if you search presidential candidate Donald Trump, that specific term, nothing comes up. If you search presidential candidate Jill Stein, her picture comes up, paraphernalia, Hillary Clinton, same thing, Bernie Sanders, same thing. So what do you believe should be done about that? I mean, that's like free speech there.
I don't like these interviews.
It doesn't have to be anything heavily philosophical, just, you know, real simple.
Google is privately owned, right?
Well, that doesn't give them the right to infringe on free speech and access to information freely.
Welcome to the media.
Thank you. So what we have here with the...
You have a spineless jellyfish is what you have.
Is just accept it. This is the theme here. It's a growing reality. Just accept it. Just accept it. The hypnosis, the psyops,
the 4 miles of fence,
repetition, just accept it.
The open theft, the lying.
Hillary Clinton is the nominee. Just accept that Google is censoring information. Just accept that Facebook is censoring information. Just accept that there will be terrorist attacks every single day in Europe and the United States. Just accept it. This is absolutely unacceptable by my standards. And this is why the globalists will take over. Because everybody's just laying.
And that is a perfect microcosm of what we run into all across the country. People just accepting their fate, their reality, and just giving in to the tyranny, saying, well, what can I do? I'm just one person. Well, when people stand up, things start to change. Obviously, we saw the 4 mile barrier get bigger because so many protesters, and these weren't Republican protesters, these weren't conservatives going there beating on gates and lighting fires. These were leftists who were pissed off about the theft from Bernie Sanders. But speaking of this except of more terror attacks, FBI boss says defeat of Islamic State means more terror in Europe and America. And that's James Comey. That's the guy who just let off Billary Clinton. Billary. At some point, there's going to be a terrorist diaspora out of Syria like we've never seen before. Not all Islamic State killers are going to die on the battlefield, which is why we shouldn't get marred in these regions and begin with. And that's, you know, one of the, probably the only positive that George, the original Grandpa Bush, old HW, did was not invade Iraq. He stopped after pushing him out of Kuwait, which they kind of baited Saddam into coming into. And now out of the UK, Merkel must go. Germans plan huge demonstration over leaders' open-door asylum policy. People are starting to get pissed, even in Germany. They are sick of the attacks. They're sick of the media covering it up. They're sick of the politicians pretending like it's not a big deal. And then here's a little meme I made last night, if you guys can get a shot of this. And it's that embrace of Hillary and Barack on the stage. I believe this is the night they actually declared her the nominee. Rest easy, girl. We've almost destroyed the country. And that's what's going to happen, people. That's what will happen if we let Hillary Clinton get in charge. So I hope you get off your duff. I hope you're doing something. I hope you're not standing by and letting these people take over. Now, before we go any further, I got another couple videos I want to play, at least parts of. But we have a bit where it's the leftovers of Operation Sleeping Giant Supercell. We're continuing the amazing savings and making them even greater. I did not remember seeing Silver Bullet 40% off over the weekend, but now it's back in stock, 40% off. If you don't have Silver Bullet in your medicine cabinet, you're crazy. That is the one of the best natural antibiotics out there, right there. And that's at 30 parts per million. Sometimes you go get it, you'll get it at a drugstore, it'll be 10 parts per million, 20 parts per million. I think if you make it yourself, the highest I've ever got it was 20 or 19 parts per million, making it myself. This is 30 parts per million. Super strong stuff. It's great. I put it on my cuts. If I get a cut, I'll put it on the Band-Aid and put it over there with a little bit of iodine. Works like a charm. Don't have to put that antibiotic cream. Also, 20% off all ProPure water filters, 40% off BrainForce, 20% off all Alexa Pure air filters, 30% off Survival Shield X2, 30% off Supermale Vitality, 30% off Vitamin Mineral Fusion. I give that to my kids. I give them half a scoop instead of a full one, and we call it Fruit Punch. They love it. You give it to your kids, too, if you feel like doing that. 30% off Secret 12. 30% off DNA Force, 20% off Survival Seeds, 20% off all shirts, 20% off Liver Shield, 30% off Deep Cleanse, 30% off Anthroplex, and 30% off Knockout. Those are amazing, amazing, amazing deals. So if you haven't tried any of the products, try them. You've seen the great reviews. I played over the Operation Sleeping Giant. I played this clip three times of this lady who had done 7 liver cleanses and pulled out thousands of stones out of her body and had pain on the right side of her body and could barely move. And she basically said, I want to thank Dr. Group for, I think, saving my life. That's how she felt. So try the products. Of course, consult your doctor. I'm not a doctor. So do your own research. Now, let's look what happens in the future if Hillary does get into office and takes her tax rates, gives us her tax hike. She wants to do another trillion in taxes. Already the income taxes that they've collected are the highest in history, and yet they still keep spending more money. Because you keep giving them more money, they think they can spend more money because they don't understand how debt works. Or I think they do. They just want to try to run this country into the ground. The American tax, it's ATR. I forget what that stands for. Americans for Tax Reform. They look at Hillary Clinton's $1 trillion in tax increases. $350 billion is going to come from itemized reductions. $275 billion through more business taxes, increase the capital gains tax, put a tax on stock trading, which is going to affect you if you hold 401ks or IRAs or any other savings accounts, and they have this exit tax where they want to go after companies that are operating all over the world, which makes sense. But the reason these companies are not operating in the United States is because there's a 39% corporate tax rate. When most of the developed world, it's at 25%. Okay, and 31 of the 34 developed countries have cut their corporate taxes since 2000. Okay, but no, not here. We need more money. Now, 10 months ago, they ATR, Americans for Tax Reform, did a analyst of Donald Trump's tax plan, and they said it looks like people are going to be making more money. He's going to simplify the individual tax brackets. He is going to take down some of the deductions, but that's where you see a lot of businesses and people taking advantage of the system. So simplifying that, make it happen quicker. Drop the business tax rate to 15%. That's going to bring businesses back from all over the world into this country, which is going to be more jobs. And with more people working, it's going to be more taxes because people are saying, well, it's going to drop our income tax levels. No, it won't. If you have more people working, it's going to raise the tax levels. And we're going to have more people working, which is going to stimulate the economy. And so you can read both of those tax plans. You just go to ATR and just look up Hillary's tax plan or Shillery's tax plan and then Donald Trump's tax reform. Incidentally, Donald Trump put his out 10 months ago. We just got Hillary's because she wants to release it during all this other turmoil that's going on. So nobody really looks at what her policies are, but they're going to cost you a lot more money. So going back to what our country will look like in a few years if Hillary gains control, how would you like to have armed soldiers at your supermarket telling you what to sell your beef at? Well, if you're the citizens and you're getting a good discount, you might like that, especially if you're hungry. But if you're the guy who's invested his time and money into starting a business, you might not like that. Here's the story of Daniel. He said the army demanded that Daniel sell his beef at 250 bolivars, roughly 25 cents at the black market rates a kilo, even though he explained it costs 3,000 bolivars to buy from his suppliers. And the military said that beef belongs to the people. There it is right there in the Financial Times. When two trucks loaded with soldiers pulled up outside his butcher shop, Daniel felt a deep unease. Yeah, that's right, because that's what they're going to do. Right now, they're having 700% inflation. They're having all kinds of controls. The government has seized the ports. Several government ministries now report directly to the Minister of Defense. And that is not the world you want to be living in. Murders off the charts. They can't do anything with the police, but what do we have here going on here still? Virginia police trained for civil unrest and race riots. That's right. They're training because they know that the economy is going to implode eventually and there will be too much debt to sustain ourselves and something's going to break it, the system. And then there's going to be riots. Will it be an EBT scam where we see nobody get their EBT food stamps, the electronic food stamp, the electronic soup line. If those stop, maybe for 2 weeks, what's going to happen? There's going to be rioting. And then you get a demand that the police take the streets and impose martial law. And it's all done on purpose. It's all done to, the command and control to ramp it up. So let's go. And then we have these people who don't believe in reality. And David Knight found another Democrat who doesn't believe in reality and just likes to schlep it off. We'll play part of this video. I'll probably cut it out halfway through, but it's called Democrat Conspiracy Theories. And it's all the Russians' fault that Hillary is a total monster and a thief in the DNC. You know, but the fact that they got caught is Russia's fault and Donald Trump's fault because Paul Manafort, worked with Russia at one time. So let's go to that video now.
My name is Marta Fedoriu, and I'm with the Ukrainian American community, and I work for the Ukrainian American Ethnic Council of the Democratic National Committee. And we are out here trying to get the word out to the American people that Trump is going to is just a disaster for America, and he's going to be a disaster for Europe because he is teamed up with Manafort, who is now his campaign chair, who is a Putin ally. He does business with him. Trump has started doing some things through his sons already. We know that. And we need information out there through the media that Putin is controlling our media even by these leaks.
Well, let me ask you about the leaks, because you mentioned that you believe that Russia was involved in these leaks. But when we look at this and you're talking about media collusion, we've seen in the content of the emails, we've seen collusion between Politico, between Washington Post and others with the DNC. Do you think that the emails are not true, that they've been doctored, or are you talking about the release of them? In other words, do you have a problem with the content of the emails or the fact that they're released?
The fact that they're released proves that Putin is behind it, because he is definitely, it's in his favor to have Trump win. So that's a fact. Now, the content, we don't know the real facts. The FBI is investigating. They could have been doctored, slightly edited. We don't know. But we know that the fact that they were released to favor Trump means Putin is behind it.
Let me ask you about the other email issue, okay, the one that Hillary Clinton had. There hasn't been a lot of concern, apparently, within the Democrat Party about the fact that national security was compromised. If you believe that the Russians were able to get the emails of the DNC and release those, are you concerned about the fact that she put top secret emails on her server that would be available to the Russians or to individual hackers or to any friend or enemy of the United States?
I am concerned about that, but I think that there has been a lot said about it that you can take it either way. She said herself if she had a choice to do it again, she wouldn't do it that way. I think she did that for expediency. It was easier, it was faster. And I don't think that, according to what I have read, I don't think that there were emails there that were considered classified at the time that she was.
The FBI director said they were sent and received as classified emails. He was very emphatic about that.
Yes.
So you think he's lying?
Possibly, because he is a Bush appointee. He is. And he did not recommend that she be indicted for that infraction. So it could be a little bit of gray in between.
Well, you know, I followed the NSA whistleblowers, and right. One of them in particular, Thomas Drake, they came after him after he had been a whistleblower, and they came after him for four emails, none of which were classified. As a matter of fact, they were things like a schedule of a project that had long since finished. They said, well, this should have been classified, and you should have known it was classified. And they came after him for possession of a classified document. They had another document that was similar to that. And they had him up for 35 years for four documents. One of them was, you know, encryption is your friend. It was a very generalized thing. It was not classified. They classified it that day and then declassified it 3 months later. I mean, how do you feel about this double standard where you have NSA whistleblowers looking at 35 years in jail? The case blew up in their face as the day they were going to trial, because that Monday is when they dropped it. The Sunday before, they had 60 minutes to reveal that. How do you feel about that versus the way Hillary Clinton was treated?
I really can't speak to that because I don't know the facts. You basically just opened my eyes to that case, the whistleblower case that was...
All right, so you see the hypocrisy, the double standard, the hypocritical attitude going on. It's okay if Hillary Clinton does it because I want her to be president. And meanwhile, an NSA whistleblower has emails retroactively made classified just so they can go arrest him. I found this on Reddit. It's pretty interesting. And it's called Too Big to Jail. You can get a shot of it over my hand. HSBC funneled $80 million to the Clinton Foundation from Swiss bank accounts, and they settled with the Justice Department for facilitating the money laundering and terrorist financing. The Senate said that they served drug kingpins and rogue nations. Well, who served on their board of directors? James Comey, right before he became the FBI director. Who brokered the HSBC settlement? Loretta Lynch. And she also let him off the hook for evading $100 million in taxes. There it is, right there. Okay, these people are above the law, and they go after anybody else who has a crooked toenail. Stay tuned. We'll be back with more. This is Rob Dewitt, the fourth hour, the Infowars.com, Alex Jones Show. So a little over a month ago, we had this video that I have on my screen here. It shows a 16-year-old black Trump supporter schooling a Black Lives Matter moron who basically said that Donald Trump was going to deport people back to Africa. And if you guys could show people on screen that video right there. There it is. 16-year-old black Trump supporter schools Black Lives Matter in moronic debate. Now, we got a video from David Knight at the DNC. And this is a Black Lives Matter supporter and Bernie Sanders delegate. He thinks Trump's going to bring back segregation. So Trump's going to do something to the blacks. He's going to do something bad. He's going to round them up. He's going to do something. So let's play that video right now.
If Donald Trump becomes president, I might have to go back to the black-only water fountain. That I might get more...
What makes you think that? I mean, he's talked about keeping the borders...
He's talked about putting up a wall from Mexico, making them build it, which will never get built. because you can't just force a whole country to build another wall against us. Talk about a shutdown, a ban on all Muslims, making fun of people who are handicapped.
Well, he's talking about getting control of immigration because we have so many people coming so quickly that we can't tell whether there's criminals or terrorists coming in. We don't know who's coming in. There's legal immigration and there's illegal immigration. He's against the illegal immigration, but I don't see him saying anything about making black people drink out of a separate water fountain.
That's not necessarily, I'm not saying as if he said that verbatim. I'm just using that as an example.
As an example? What?
Thank you very much. Thank you for talking to us.
Ridiculous. You can watch the whole video. BLM supporter thinks Trump will bring back segregation. Actually, the people who want to bring back segregation are the blacks themselves. Exclusive new Black Panther leader. Blacks need to migrate to 5 southern states, form country within a country. So they're saying it. Donald Trump's not saying it. They're saying it right there. And this was, let's see, July 10th. So about 18 days ago. Right there. And, you know, blacks before, you know, the generation before these youngsters running around fought to not have separate water fountains, to be able to eat in the same restaurant, to integrate into American society fully. And we have that now. And they want to turn back the clock and say, well, we don't want to deal with white people anymore. We don't like them. Well, that's just going to, that, you know, I guess that's their own problem. So I don't even know what to say. They're fed disinformation through these leftist media outlets because they want you to be afraid and they don't want you to talk to people. I think we've had some of the best discourses at the DNC, and I thought that was going to be the most violent towards our reporters. And I was wrong. It wasn't. They were the Bernie people were open to talk. They wanted to talk. They wanted to exchange ideas. You know, I don't agree with their economic policies, but I think, you know, there are places for us where we can find common ground and then help take this country back from the globalists, because those are the people who are in control. Donald Trump hasn't been in office yet. He didn't cause all this. Hillary Clinton's 30 plus years in office. What has she done? What has she done? She called black people super predators. That's what she's done. She put more people in prison under her husband, under their crime bill. So, and there's this little thing called NAFTA, the giant sucking sound. Once again, all Operation Sleeping Giant Supercell fundraisers are still in effect. 40% off BrainForce, 40% off Silver Bullet, 20% off all Pro Pure water filters, 20% off Alexa Pure air filters, 30% off X2, Supermail Vitality, Vitamin Mineral Fusion, Secret 12, DNA Force, 20% off Survival Sheets, all T-shirts, Liver Shield, Deep Cleanse, Anthroplex, and Knockout. Thank you for supporting us. If you have been, please spread the word. Infowars.com/show. Alex will be back Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. And it's the nightly news tonight, 7 p.m. Central. Thanks for watching and spread the word, people. This is how we're going to take our country back with a free exchange of ideas.